employment, on the other hand, allows employers to let go their employees at any time without notice for any cause or for no reason, so long as the basis for the hiring is not discriminatory under law. Currently, all 50 states and Washington, D.C. are at-will employment jurisdictions, although certain states have limited exceptions to the at-will rules. New York State is an at-will state, meaning that all employees, with the exceptions of collectively bargained agreements, employees are considered at will. Employees can be fired without warning at any time for any reason or no reason at all, although there are legal protections in place to ensure that employees are not fired due to identity or physical characteristics. Many employers in at will employment jurisdictions have the ability to lawfully terminate their employees due to a wide range of reasons or no reasons at all. On one hand, this allows employees flexibilities to fire and manage their staff more easily and allows employees and employers to work together without long-term contracts or promises from either party. Just as employees are able to fire an employee without notice, employees are also able to leave their jobs freely. However, on the other hand, at-will employees can make it more difficult for employees to prove instances of wrongful or illegal termination. Wrongful terminations, particularly common within the fast food industry, New York has approximately 3,000 fast food locations that employ nearly 67,000 people, with two-thirds of that being women and two-thirds being immigrants. Two-thirds being women, a third of them immigrants, and 88% of the workforce are people of color. Since the fast food industry in New York City is generally made up of women, immigrants, and people of color, difficulty in improving wrongful termination may be exacerbated by mistreatment already existing within the industry. The council is committed to ensuring that these fast food workers have the dignity and respect and the legal protections that they deserve, and that this committee will be at the forefront of all his efforts in doing so. We thank the administration as well as the industry stakeholders who are here present today and for those who will be testifying. I'd like to thank my staff, Chief of Staff Councilmember Ali Rasulnijad, Brandon Clark, my legislative director, and I would also like to thank the central staff for all the work that they have done in preparation. Nuzak, Kevin, Kendall, Elizabeth, and John, great job. Let me also say that we've been, before we hear from our two sponsors, Councilmember Adams and Councilmember Landers for opening remarks, we've been joined by one of our distinguished colleagues from across the seas, Councilmember Seamus DeFoy. Welcome, and it is an honor and pleasure to have you in the chambers, and certainly you're welcome in the People's House at any time. With that, I'd like to call on Councilmember Adams for her opening statement.
Thank you, Chair Miller, and good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to start again by thanking Chair Miller for allowing me to deliver comments about an important bill to many workers in our city, Intro 1396. For far too long, fast food workers have been subjected to unfair work environments and have been the victims of unfair reduction of hours or arbitrary termination, causing them to live in a constant state of uncertainty. These employees are getting up before dawn or working overnight, commuting long hours to work, doing physically demanding work, and missing meals with their families. In exchange, they are often faced with impossible choices: endure hostile working conditions, leave, or be fired and face financial struggle without a job. This is simply unacceptable. New York City's fast food industry has served as a laboratory for the nation's labor movement for the last several years, and it is the natural place to start with just cause legislation. Many of these families are already living paycheck to paycheck and losing their job for no reason whatsoever. This can have catastrophic effects. This legislation is a chance for hardworking New Yorkers to finally have the peace of mind that comes with knowing that they will be treated with the dignity and respect they deserve. I'd like to thank my colleague and partner in the Just Cause package, Councilmember Brad Lander. I'd also like to thank my legislative and communications coordinator, Stacey Yearwood, for all of her hard work. I'd like to thank 32BJ, the Center for Popular Democracy, Fast Food Justice, and the National Employment Law Project for their support of this important legislation. Most importantly, I'd like to thank the fast food workers of New York City who continue to fight for the rights on their job. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, so we do this, and I know it's going to be a lot of cheering moments today, but just as a reminder, particularly for those BJ members that are often here, this is how we show our appreciation, okay? So we're now going to hear from Councilmember Brad Lander.
Thank you very much, Chair Miller. I want to thank you for scheduling this hearing. There's obviously a lot of business before the Civil Service and Labor Committee, and we're grateful for the opportunity to have these bills heard today, and it is an honor to be doing this in partnership with Councilmember Adrienne Adams. She's the lead sponsor of Intro 1396, and I'm the lead sponsor of Intro 1415. Despite the fact that fast food workers have some of the most precarious jobs in our very unequal economy, they have been on the front lines of winning dignity and making jobs better and turning what have been low-wage, tenuous, precarious jobs into ones on which you could support a family, have some dignity, and be a human being in New York City. That goes way back. It was fast food workers who helped lead the way on the fight to win paid sick days for all New Yorkers. It was fast food workers who went out in those first strikes. The first one was in Brooklyn in the fight for 15, and not only won $15 an hour for themselves, but started a movement all across the country that has now over 10 million workers earning $15 and 22 million workers having received minimum wage increases. Fast food workers who because they were subject to precarious scheduling with no advance notice, with no pathway to full-time jobs, won the Fair Workweek laws that we passed here and have now also been passed in Seattle and San Francisco and Philadelphia and across the country. But when we learn from fast food workers that this challenge in all of it is knowing that you could be fired on a moment's notice without a reason, without any warning, you know, because you didn't smile nicely at the boss, because one customer complained about you, or with no reason at all, because you would never be told, the courage that it took to fight all those fights became dramatically more clear. In a study last year by the Center for Popular Democracy and Make the Road, 65% of fast food workers who had been terminated said that they had not been given a reason for the termination. And when you know that you don't have to be given any reason, when you could be fired on a moment's notice, then how can you complain when that boss says, "I expect you to smile at me," or says more than that? How can you stand up for yourself in the face of sexual harassment? How can you say, "I need next Thursday off to go take care of my mom or my kid"? How can you have the courage to organize together with other workers to make your workplace a place of dignity? You really can't. So the courage that it has taken to win all those things and now to bring this to us, I think I just really want to give, as Councilmember Adams did, just a great deal of credit to the fast food workers who are here. I've had the honor to be out with you on the picket lines that you've been on across the city. You are transforming the economy in a direction of fairness and dignity, and it's an honor for us to be your allies in doing that. What you're fighting for here is just such a normal, obvious, basic thing. I mean, this would in some ways be a big change in our economy to go from at-will employment to just cause for folks who aren't in a union. And yet, on the other hand, if you would say to most people, "Do you think it's right that people could be fired without any reason or any notice?" Obviously, anyone would say, no, that is not right. Of course, any decent employer would have a policy in place in which it was clear what the standards were, and if you follow them, you keep your job, and if you don't, you get some feedback and an opportunity to improve, and it's clear what the cause is for which you might be fired, and you would be told what it was before you were. That is not like a big dream in the sky. That is just a basic way of treating people like human beings, and it makes for good workplaces also. So, we might get asked later today, you know, is this something that all workers should have? And I'll answer it in advance. I think yes. I think all workers should have this protection, but fast food workers in New York City are a great place to start because you've organized, because it's clear that this is a significant problem in the fast food sector, and I think someday after we pass this here in New York City and it spreads all around the country, a whole lot of workers who have dignity and protections they lack today will have New York City fast food workers to thank. I also want to thank SEIU 32BJ for their support. I want to thank my staff, Steph Sokowski and Naomi Dan, CPD, Make the Road. We're going to hear from Sean Richmond later, and everybody who's been working hard to lift up this issue. But again, to begin and end with thanking the workers whose courage has gotten us here today. Thanks very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Lander, and you certainly can do this. It deserves it. We are now going to hear from the panel, the administration here, and so we're going to Commissioner Salas and Deputy Commissioner Holt. We're going to have counsel affirm you.
Please raise your right hand. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
I do.
Okay, you may begin your testimony.
Good morning, Chair Miller and members of the committee and everyone in the room. My name is Lorelei Salas and I am the commissioner for the Department of Consumer and Worker Protection. And as you heard, I am joined today by my colleague, Ben Holt, Deputy Commissioner for DCWP, for short. We would like to thank the committee for the opportunity to testify today on introductions 1415 and 1396 relating to wrongful discharge from employment and fast food employee layoffs, respectively. DCWP's mission is to protect and enhance the daily economic lives of New Yorkers to create thriving communities. As part of this mission, DCWP serves as New York City's central resource for workers. The agency promotes policies that create fair workplaces, ensuring workers are empowered to realize their rights and protections. Key workplace laws we enforce include paid safe and sick leave and fair work week laws, as well as the Freelancer System Free Act, which have helped to elevate labor standards for thousands of workers across New York City. I'd like to talk a little bit about the fast food industry and fair work week laws. The bills under consideration today touch upon an industry that we are all well acquainted with, the fast food industry. Workers in the fast food industry have historically been confronted with declining real wages and unstable working schedules. However, these workers, more than 67,000 in New York City alone, have continually fought to address these challenges. Most recently, this administration fought alongside them for a $15 minimum wage to end abusive scheduling practices and to promote full-time employment in the industry. During the council's deliberation on the Fair Work Week legislation, the administration testified to and cited extensive research that highlighted the negative impacts of unpredictable and unstable schedules in the fast food industry. As you may know, unpredictable schedules have negative impacts for both workers and businesses. For workers, the instability makes it hard to work a second job, to manage a household budget, to go to school or arrange for childcare and elder care. For businesses, unpredictable schedules are associated with understaffing at peak business hours and weak execution of business practices processes, resulting in poor customer service, reduced sales, and lower productivity. Today, thanks to the Council's passage of Fair Work Week legislation, New York is the largest city in the country to take steps toward ending abusive scheduling practices for fast food workers. Fair Work Week guaranteed fast food workers at chain establishments of 30 locations or more nationally two things: greater predictability through advanced scheduling and premium pay requirements, and the chance to work full-time by picking up shifts before new workers can be hired. As the agency charged with implementation and enforcement of Fair Work Week laws, DCWP educates stakeholders, holds trainings, and meets with businesses and workers alike to ensure their familiarity with the law. Since 2017, DCWP has conducted more than 550 worker-related educational events. This past December, we visited more than 200 businesses in commercial districts in all five boroughs to educate employers about Fair Work Week laws. Later this year, we also plan to conduct a citywide public awareness campaign highlighting these protections for both workers and businesses. DCWP also holds fast food employers to account for non-compliance with Fair Work Week, having completed 83 investigations and obtained resolutions awarding $1.3 million in restitution and fines. And this covers and impacts over 3,000 workers. This is since the law went into effect 2 years ago. We're currently pursuing another 34 active investigations. We have filed litigation against prominent fast food brands such as KFC, McDonald's, and Chipotle, to name a few. Our enforcement activities focus on ensuring that workers are made whole for past violations of their rights and that workplaces are in compliance with the law going forward. We work together with employers to create a proactive plan for coming into compliance as part of a larger effort to use both education and enforcement to promote a culture of compliance that protects workers and gives employers the information and tools they need to meet their obligations, and in so doing, to reduce future business costs. Fair Work Week is aimed at alleviating the unstable working conditions that are prominent in the fast food industry, which just a short time ago reported a yearly staff turnover of 150%. However, we believe there is still more than can be done to realize these protections and ensure these workers have stability in their lives and the means to support themselves and their families. This leads us to the bills before the committee today. Introduction 1415. Too often, fast food workers face the injustice of arbitrary and wrongful discharge. They are discharged or have their hours cut for not smiling enough, for not having the right hat, or for having nails that are too long. Moreover, 65% of fast food workers reported being given no explanation at all for their termination. Imagine working hard at your job and one day being fired, losing your source of income, beset with uncertainty, and not knowing why or what caused it to happen. We are also aware that workers are too frequently dismissed in retaliation for asserting their rights under the Fair Work Week laws, a practice that is already illegal but highlights just how precarious fast food work is. For a worker to be able to defend their rights at work by pointing out unlawful practices and reporting violations, it is critically important that they're both protected against termination as a reprisal. To that end, 1415 supplements and strengthens the anti-retaliation protections for fast food workers in Fair Work Week laws. In addition, 1415 would give fast food workers greater certainty about their employment. So long as a worker is performing adequately, they will have a reasonable expectation of continued employment. 1415 does not eliminate businesses' ability to remove employees who fail to perform or engage in misconduct. Instead, it promotes transparency in the workplace and protects employees from arbitrary dismissals for which they're not at fault. Just cause standards are not new and have been negotiated and arbitrated by employers and unions for more than a century. In addition, the state of Montana has had a statewide just cause standard since 2001, and Philadelphia has a similar protection for parking lot attendants, which went into effect in September 2019. And I just read that Puerto Rico has just cause protections too. 1415 contemplates using similar standards that have been developed over time to assess whether employers have met just cause. We look forward to examining in greater detail just how just cause standards have been applied in other jurisdictions and how they might be incorporated into the city's legal landscape. Still, these cases are likely to be factually complex and are most similar to the retaliation cases we already handle. Retaliatory dismissals represent some of DCWP's most challenging investigatory work and present imminent concern for workers who are out of work and missing a paycheck. Just to give you an idea of how often we hear of retaliation in these cases, out of approximately 82 investigations closed in the fast food industry alone, almost half of those cases presented allegations of retaliation, which can involve anything from discharge to a reduction in hours to threats. These are cases we take very seriously, but half of those cases include allegations of retaliation. That is a huge percentage. For this reason, DCWP utilizes a fast-track process when employers take retaliatory measures against their workers. This entails conducting a separate, specialized investigation focusing only on the retaliatory firing with strict deadlines for collecting and weighing the relevant evidence. These cases are typically focused only a single complainant, but usually involve competing factual accounts and mixed motivations that take care and time to sort out. Overall, Introduction 1415 builds on Fair Workweek's ideals of enhanced predictability and job quality by giving fast food workers increased job stability. We support this goal and believe there is a strong factual record demonstrating just how important this would be for fast food workers in New York City. Introduction 1396 ensures that employers have the ability to make business decisions based on reasonable, objective economic circumstances. It sets forth parameters for layoffs of fast food employees when a business has a bona fide economic reason for doing so. DCWP believes that this is a sensible complement to the goals of just cause standards in balancing an employee's right to more predictable employment with an employer's legitimate business needs to adjust staffing levels. There are existing legal frameworks for assessing businesses' financial condition and whether layoffs are factually supported. Under the Federal National Labor Relations Act and other laws, legal tests have been developed to examine economic health that can be used and built upon for 1396. An arbitrary or wrongful dismissal is all too common, much more common than we should expect. In fact, in one poll, 90% of workers expected that they were protected from being fired for an arbitrary reason, such as their supervisor simply disliking them. We know that this is not the case for fast food workers without the protections such as those contemplated in Introductions 1396 and 1415. In supporting just cause standards, our priority is to ensure it is a protection that is embraced by workers, is reasonable for businesses, and is effectively enforced. While this innovative and groundbreaking policy builds upon Fair Workweek enforcement and our anti-retaliation measures, it will require additional personnel to perform outreach, implementation, intake, investigations, and litigation in order to ensure businesses understand how to comply and to protect workers who are illegally dismissed. Under the Fair Workweek laws, workers have available to them a combination of agency-led and private enforcement, which is an approach that has leveraged our existing enforcement model. The bills today include three distinct enforcement options: administrative enforcement, a private right of action, and a DCWP-overseen arbitration process. DCWP does not currently administer an arbitration system. We would like to work with counsel to understand how this process would work and what resources and expertise are needed for it to be implemented effectively. Additionally, we would like to work with counsel through the legislative process to ensure there is clear guidance on items such as bona fide economic reasons for termination and just cause to facilitate clarity and flexibility for businesses. We note that the law department is currently reviewing the bills as well. In closing, both introductions 1396 and 1415 help provide workers increased stability in both their working and personal lives. We look forward to working with the council on these bills and other progressive policies that ensure New York City remains at the forefront of workers' rights issues in our country. Once again, thank you, Chair and members of the committee, for the opportunity to testify today, and we'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Commissioner. So, based on that fine testimony, one might assume that the administration was in favor of these two pieces of legislation, but I don't want to assume, so I will ask the question, do you support these two pieces of legislation?
We certainly support the goals of the legislation. I would just say that the law department, as I mentioned, is reviewing the language. We do have some questions around operational issues and how to put this in place, but we believe these are protections that would add to the already great array of benefits the city is providing for workers.
So certainly that is the goal of this committee and this council, to make sure that happens, and how we actually get to that point, implementation, and we want to make sure that we're working with the administration. So aside from implementation, rollout, and so forth, because we do have some questions about whether or not your agency has the ability to enforce, and the staff and resources, we know that we have challenged the agency over the last few years with some of the policy that's come out of the council here. First of all, do you have the capacity to address this, considering the cases that we have seen over the past few years, as well as do you anticipate any legal litigations around this? Are there any such concerns? And to speak to some of the states and municipalities that may employ these standards already, and in terms of what best practices look like and what you have seen, thus what we might anticipate here.
Yes, thank you for the question. I would say, and you've heard me say this before, I always say that my agency tries to do the best we can with the resources we have at our disposal. I do believe, though, this mandate will require additional resources for the agency. The arbitration program itself is something that is not currently something we handle, and obviously would have to be, come out of city funding. I think that I'm being very frank about this. You know, we want to be able to make sure that these protections are real for workers, and that requires additional staffing. It's hard to tell right now what that would be, because until we see the final language and we have further discussions as to what the arbitration process would look like, we'll have a better sense of the necessary staffing needs. We are, however, very proud of everything we've been able to accomplish with the resources we have. And we have, exceeded $11, $12 million already in restitution across the different laws that we enforce, like paid safe and sick leave and Fair Work Week, and the Freelancers Season Free Act. So I think that we've managed to do a good job until now. But as you know, we could be doing more, and we certainly would welcome additional resources to do the work. I want to answer the question regarding having spoken to other states and municipalities. We've been able to connect with Philadelphia, the city of Philadelphia, and I'll let my colleague Ben speak a little bit about that.
Thank you for having me here as well today. I haven't had a chance to say that yet. So we have had some preliminary discussions with the city of Philadelphia regarding their Just Cause law that went into effect in September of 2019. It's a relatively short time period. However, there are a couple early findings or things they've been able to report about their experience. One is that so far there has not been a deluge of complaints. I believe they've had very few, possibly as few as one complaint in the first 5 months of their law. Now, their law applies to a different industry. It's parking lot attendants, which covers approximately 1,000 workers in Philadelphia. One of the other key findings they've had so far is that because this law requires understanding by both businesses and workers, that there are increased needs for outreach and education around just cause and what it means, both for businesses so that they know how to comply, but also for workers so that they understand what the protection is and how they can assert that right.
If I may add one more thing, this doesn't really go to resources, but I would say that currently we have some issues with our enforcement powers and some of the decisions that are coming out of the Oath Tribunal. To be perfectly honest, that the tribunal has found that in some cases our authority is not fully clear on the fact that we can recover restitution for workers and consumers, which is obviously the whole point of these important protections you are all legislating and putting in place. And we have before you a couple of pieces of legislation that we hope that you would support, because they complement anything that you know you envision would add protections for workers.
Okay, so along that line, so currently, does your agency how many wrongful terminations? Because even though the oversight doesn't exist there, but certainly the complaints come through DCWP, right? So how many wrongful terminations within the industry are we seeing on average?
So to this point, the commissioner has spoken to our retaliation work, which is one of our highest priorities in the fast food industry, and this is covering the approximately 2+ year period that it's been in effect. We've had about 45 investigations closed that involved allegations of retaliation.
Okay, and so in terms of how do we remedy, what would be the mechanism? And obviously there was a number that was discussed. And so could you speak to that in particular, based on what you had before and some of the oversight that you're charged with, is there do you deal with arbitration panels or other mechanisms of enforcement that would that would address these issues?
I'll start and then Ben can help me. But I would say that, so right now we do not have an arbitration model in place, right? All our enforcement is handled by investigators, attorneys who are employed by my office, who will take complaints. And oftentimes in cases in which we suspect the violations affect multiple workers, we'll extend those cases to include the entire workplace. I'll say that for our retaliation cases, in the different laws that we enforce, we have very strong protections. We're able to, obviously the council was very supportive of including strong anti-retaliation language in our laws. And therefore, in many cases, we've been able to both either get workers reinstated, which is something that is very important to workers, but in many cases, it's about providing them with a monetary award for having been either fired or having had their hours reduced. Typically, an average recovery is about $9,000. That is, Ben said, these are cases that we take very seriously. We fast track those cases to make sure that we're quickly addressing the potentially retaliatory activity and to make sure that other workers' voices don't get chilled if they see that someone has been displaced of their jobs because they filed a complaint or they simply asserted their rights. Just to be clear, workers don't have to necessarily file a complaint with us, but if they go to their employer and they say, well, I haven't received my premium pay or my paid sick day, and the employer takes an action, that is enough of a retaliatory action for us to intervene.
So as far as the role that the agency would play moving forward in terms of enforcement, do you see the agency playing the same role in terms of enforcement or oversight and investigation? Is that something within the authority of the agency or would we feel more comfortable with sort of a tri-panel? And the agency played a smaller role there, but that we had employees and certainly workers on the panel? Do we see that as a more viable and equitable way to serve justice?
So I would say two things about that. We're obviously most familiar with our own enforcement mechanisms, right? And we would take these cases. They would be very similar to our retaliation cases, which do take a lot of resources, but we know how to do our work. Because of the challenges I expressed in terms of some of the decisions from the tribunal and the need to really fix our language, and there's also, we lack an ability to appeal those decisions from oath, I think that today an arbitration panel would probably better serve workers.
Okay, thank you. We've been joined by Council Member Aldridge, Council Member Rosenthal, and we are going to take some questions from colleagues now. Councilmember Lander? Councilmember Adams?
We're such gentlemen and gentleladies up here. It's just wonderful to work with my colleagues, I've got to say that. Thank you again, Mr. Chair. Thank you so much for your testimony thus far. We appreciate your candor. As one sponsor of one of these bills primarily, specifically 1396, I'm interested to know, we know that you've said that you support the legislation, which we thank you for that, but you also said that you would like to, and I'm paraphrasing, perhaps tweak the language a little bit, so I'm just curious to know. You mentioned operational specs, I believe. Can you drill a little bit down a little bit more for us and give us some more specifics on how you would tweak the language in either piece of legislation, actually, and what are your concerns, if any, with this legislation?
I would just say that, again, we support the legislation. We do believe that it's important for there to be a lot of clarity on the definitions of when we talk about bona fide economic reason, what do we really mean there? When we talk about reduction of hours by 15%, for that to be a layoff, what are we saying there? Are we saying that a reduction of hours on any week or a permanent reduction of hours? I think it will be important to just make sure that the language is clear enough so both employers understand their obligations, but also workers understand when they have, when they are experiencing a violation of the law, right? We would love to keep working with the council on this, and we noted that there is already some language that we could look to under the National Labor Relations Act, and we could be speaking to them about how in practice they're able to investigate these issues.
Okay, that's fair. I'm sorry.
If I could just add
yes,
to that.
Yes, please.
Obviously, one of our priorities is how can we implement and enforce this effectively. With respect to bona fide economic reasons, just cause, what those mean, there are criteria set forth in the bills. And I think we just want to do a little bit more work to understand exactly how those standards would play out in practice. And our viewpoint, and kind of going back to the importance of outreach and education here, is we want to just make sure we end up in a place where we can give clear guidance to employers, clear guidance to workers, so everyone understands ahead of time exactly how these are going to work.
So to what extent have you actually explored the policy, legal, and or economic dimensions of extending the provisions of the bills to other industries even, particularly those where poor working conditions and or low union density are known to prevail?
I mean, the straight answer is we haven't. We can tell you about the cases that we touch on, and we can tell you about the types of violations we see, and we see in this particular industry, as you've all said already, a majority of workers are immigrants, people of color, many are women, we think that in this industry, they're documented what we call like really lack of protections for workers, and it's documented at the national level, at state level, at the city level. So we are ready to start with this industry, and we would love to continue to have discussions as to whether it would be appropriate to extend the same protections to other industries.
And what do you think would be some of the pros or cons, even, of potentially applying these provisions to other low-wage sectors?
I mean, the pros, obviously, I think it would bring stability to workers' lives, right? My office also hosts the Office of Financial Empowerment, and we work with individual New Yorkers to make sure that they budget accordingly, that they're able to tackle their debt. And if a worker comes in and they tell us, I have no idea how much money I'm going to earn this month, right? Or I don't know if I'm going to be employed next week. That is an issue, right? It really affects the financial health of New Yorkers. We do point out in our testimony that these policies not just provide for better working conditions, but also improve businesses' productivity, and employees are happier at work, and it provides for a better service to customers. I would say that, you know, we talk about Just Cause just being, you know, New York City potentially being one of the first big cities in the country to pass these protections, but Just Cause standards are very typical for CEOs in employment contracts, according to an op-ed I just read recently. So it turns out that the higher paid employees actually have access to all of these protections, but not the employees who need it the most, right? So I see benefits. I do think that, again, the challenge is in making sure that the law is understood clearly by employers, and we put a lot of resources into educating our business community. As you know, and other members of the committee, we are really always thinking about events where we can go, provide education to business owners, especially in their own workplace, in their own businesses. So we invest heavily in making sure that they have tools that they need to comply with these laws, with any new laws that come into place.
Okay, my final question is going to be, how do you think that small businesses and unions will be affected by this legislation?
Well, so I would say one thing, that the law, these protections build on the Fair Work Week laws in terms of the definition of who gets covered, which type of establishment gets covered by these protections or these obligations. And we are talking about either chains or franchises that have 30 or more establishments nationally, right? So through our work, we've seen primarily corporations or owners of establishments that have operators that have several locations in place. So I think we're talking again about an industry in which the majority of the cases we're seeing come through our doors are for people who should be capable of implementing these practices, who have the resources to do that. And it wouldn't apply to a small, like a pizzeria in the neighborhood, right? That's not what's envisioned under this proposal. And I'm sorry, but I think I only addressed one part of your question. If you can repeat.
No, it's okay, because you addressed the part that I was really trying to get to, because there has been buzz out there that this will greatly impact small businesses. So I just wanted to get your take on that.
Yeah, and I will just repeat again that, you know, the cases that we publicized have been cases of litigation and complaints that we receive in companies like Chipotle and McDonald's. So those are well-known establishments and companies, again, that have resources to put these protections in place.
Okay, that's good enough for me. Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you, Deputy Commissioner, for your testimony.
Yep.
You're
and,
welcome.
Before we go to Councilmember Landers, I think the second part was the impact on small businesses and unions. And if you care to articulate further.
The impact on unions, I mean, I would not be able to predict what impact this would have on union establishments. I can tell you that we have other laws, right? Paid safe and sick leave, which provide for basic minimum protections. I think that there are, it's a similar legislation where in this case, we're providing basic protections and it's a floor. and unions can always negotiate about above that floor.
Okay, Councilmember Land.
Thank you very much, Chair. First of all, let me thank both of you for the work that you've done in standing up the Office of Labor and Policy Standards at DCWP, which has really done just a great job of, you know, I don't know that I think it's gotten enough credit for what it means that New York City has this worker protection agency that has recovered all those resources for workers and set a whole set of people who didn't have them before. So I just want to thank you for that work. And actually just transitioning from that to sort of the impacts, because I know we'll hear some of this later. Now we're, when we started talking about paid sick days, we heard, oh, there'll be mass business closures. And when we were doing Fair Work Week, we were told that would have a very big impact on people's ability to operate. And of course, even though we don't enforce the $15 minimum wage here, we were also told that will. But you've been doing a lot of enforcement now on especially paid sick days and Fair Work Week for a while, and I have not noticed like a massive number of fast food closings or, you know, the industry in free fall in New York City. It seems like we see the operation of fast food businesses continuing with workers having paid sick days, getting paid $15 an hour, and with some exceptions that you guys are enforcing, mostly having their rights followed, and they get 2 weeks advance notice of their schedule and access to hours. Am I missing something, or is the industry continuing to operate pretty well while providing a lot more dignity and stability to its workers?
The industry is still in place. That's true. And I would just say that thank you. Thank you for, you know, championing these protections for workers. But we can do more, obviously, right? I mean, we've done a lot of enforcement in this area, but we could always do more. And I think there's more, definitely more work to be done to make sure that these protections are real for all of the workers in New York City. You know, we are at a, we have record employment numbers. Our economy keeps thriving. There's been reports of how the restaurant industry continues to grow despite all of these protections. And there are definitely studies that we'll be happy if either to provide or Ben can speak about them that talk about how the effect of the minimum wage hasn't really affected businesses in a way that we sometimes hear it could. So we continue to operate, you know, enforce our laws. We often are able to, you know, the goal really is to have these protections be real. It's not about assessing fines. That's not the goal of it. And so that is our main objective, to create a culture of compliance, and we can do that without assessing fines. Well, great. Yeah. But, you know, people need to comply with the law.
And it strikes me on this one, I mean, obviously paying a higher minimum wage has an economic impact on a company, and giving advance notice of schedules, you might need some software to change your practices. Giving paid sick days might actually cost a little bit of money, but this one doesn't need to cost you anything, as I understand it. You know, I mean, providing your workers some understanding of what the provisions they have to follow are, and then following those rules, and that's just a good business practice, yes, that doesn't, you know, I think could have even less financial impact or bottom line impact than some of the other legislation we've talked about so far.
Yes, I mean, absolutely. We think that in this case, you know, the employers are already hiring the workers. There's a probationary period. It's only after that the worker passes that probationary period that the provisions apply. And so we do think that there isn't really a cost associated with this, but we would be happy to, and we have done this in the past, come up with templates or model forms that could make it easier for employers to just borrow that and use that and not have to spend time doing it.
So that's a great transition to my next kind of comment or question, because I think your point about looking together at the language is a good one. We also want it to be really clear. And some of this, of course, is common sense, but in a way that we're not necessarily going to spell out in the law, and we should think together about what's in the law, if there are rules, and what's in the rules, and definitely what's in the template. And, you know, I'll just give the example of, obviously, there's like a big difference between persistent lateness, for example. So, like, if an employee comes in late, you know, normally, like, maybe the first time you get a verbal warning from the manager, you know, don't be late again. At some point you get a written warning, and at some point persistent lateness, if you're always coming in late and therefore disrespecting your colleagues and making it hard for the business to operate, can become a legitimate cause for termination. That is different, very different from, you know, something like, let's say if a worker physically assaults another worker in the workplace, okay? Like that would be, could be grounds for immediate termination. Everyone knows you don't do that, and you don't need, like, you know, a verbal warning and a written warning and then a third incident. And the law actually makes very clear that, that something like that, particularly egregious incidents, you know, that could be an immediate termination. So we want to work together to make sure that this is clear, because it's obviously possible to put policies in place that let people know what their responsibilities are, have everybody follow the rules and guidelines in a pretty reasonable way. And I think this is a situation where kind of everyone has a common sense of what's a good reason and not a good reason, but we want to do as you know, well in the law of making it clear, in part so that then when there are complaints and issues that need to be resolved through a complaint jurisdiction, we'll have clarity. So let me drill down a little just on that. If I understand you right around the retaliatory firings, I guess, like, it's easy enough to know if someone did or didn't give someone 2 weeks advance notice of their schedule. Like, they can either provide you evidence they did or they can't provide you evidence that they did. It's a relatively a matter of fact. I assume that in the cases of these retaliatory firings, the worker is saying, you know, I believe I was fired in retaliation. Here's a thing I did. And then after I did that, you know, I joined a workplace action. And then after I did that, I lost my hours, or, you know, and maybe the company's saying, well, we didn't even know they, you know, so you have to adjudicate a kind of more complex set of, I don't want to say he said, she said, but where there's two sides and you're going through and trying to really get to the bottom of what happened. Is that, is that right?
Absolutely. I'll let Ben explain a little more how we deal with these cases, but I mean, it's true. There are two sides to the story, and it takes more digging in and more interviews, and oftentimes we'll go beyond the two, you know, the worker who filed the complaint and the employer, but we talk to other workers, right? And so we have experience doing that, but I'll let Ben develop a little more.
Yeah, so our retaliation cases are extremely fact-specific. They often do lead us to a place where we have competing versions of what happened. So there are questions about weighing statements from different parties, making assessments of credibility, also looking at whether or not other similarly situated workers have been treated in the same way by that employer. And that I would actually note, I think, is one of the pieces of our retaliation work that is actually quite immediately transferable to something like progressive discipline, looking at whether or not the employer is treating other similarly situated workers in the same way, applying the same standards across the board to all of their workers. But they are very complicated cases, even though they are typically only involving a single complainant for us. All of the factual digging and weighing that we have to do is quite resource intensive.
I mean, it strikes me here the same would be true around 1415. Some situations would be pretty straightforward. If you didn't get any notice or any warning or any reason, they'd be pretty, you know, I mean, obviously the employer could show that you did, but if you didn't, there'd be nothing to show. That's pretty straightforward. If there was a situation where there had just been documented progressive discipline, also pretty easy for the employer to provide evidence that they complied with the law. But you could imagine situations where there was some disagreement about what had happened and someone would need to dig in and really do that fact finding. And so I just wanna end asking about, since you raised it, the arbitration panel pathway. Because I think you're right. You know, I think people feel very encouraged by how you guys have been doing enforcing these other laws. And so the having the pathway where people can come to you, where you guys can move quite quickly if it's an issue of termination, obviously, because you want to, you know, move quickly in that situation. And what the person really wants is their job back. So that's valuable. You guys can move in quickly. We like having that pathway. It has some of the challenges that you described with oaths authority. And maybe some of those can get remedied through things we can do or things the state legislature can do. Most of the laws, or at least several of them, already have a private right of action. Page 6A actually doesn't, although probably we should fix that. But it's a challenge for people to go to court. They have to hire a lawyer. It can take a long time. So it's a good to be able to vitiate your rights in court, but it can be a challenging pathway. And so I think the idea here was, if there were an arbitration panel, the fact-finding can then get done. There is an arbitrator. You got to have a panel that was agreed on by some set of both employers and worker representatives. And then, at least as I understand it, that order has a binding authority that is as strong as the courts would be without having to go to court. Mm-hmm. So is that's your understanding as well?
Yes, and I'm not expert on that, right? But I would just say yes. So the both parties agree, or the worker submits himself or herself to arbitration, they are bound by the decision from the arbitrator or the panel. So it is definitely another avenue and possibly a faster way of getting their cases resolved faster than going to, you know, to court on their own privately and having to hire a lawyer to represent them. So for us, it's mostly just questions about how to make it operational and where the funding comes from to put that in place.
Yes.
But it's certainly an avenue for workers.
Great. And it sounds like you would need some additional resources, whether it was to stand up an arbitration panel or to have the staff in place to handle complaints and investigations, you know, on this new law beyond what you're getting in any case.
I mean, even with the arbitration panel, right, a lot of the fact finding would be done by them, but there's still an administrative piece to it that would require us to assign staff to set that up and make sure that it's running well.
Okay. I'm eager to hear from some workers and some employers, so I don't want to take more time with you guys, but I really appreciate the seriousness. You know, having a city agency that takes these issues seriously, that's really listening and building a practice, you know, whatever, makes me proud of New York, so thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Landon. We're going to hear from Councilmember Aldridge.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to apologize for being late. I did have a chance to read the testimony, and I have a few concerns. In advance of the hearing, I'd read a couple of articles about the number of fast food chain establishments that have closed in New York City alone. I think close to 150 in the past couple of years. I think the number was 148, if I'm not mistaken. I know that the mayor recently announced in his State of the City address that he wanted to make an initiative supporting small businesses. I don't see how supporting these pieces of legislation advances that. Considering how many fast food establishments are closing, the McDonald's in my district, many of them have recently been renovated. As a result of their renovations, they've moved to automation. They've eliminated the number of jobs that were there previously. They've reduced the number of jobs that were there previously. I just think all these unfunded mandates that we're placing on the small business community is hurting low-wage workers, is hurting the people that we need to create more jobs for. And I just want to say on the record that, you know, the economy is doing great now, thank God, but we know that that is not always going to be the case. And one of the provisions of the bills, if I'm not mistaken, would force a small business to prove an economic hardship in making the decision to lay off certain employees. Why should we have to wait for the bad times for small businesses to have to prove to the city and shift that burden of proof onto them? Small businesses make long-term business planning and models based on their budget, based on the economy, based on shifting, you know, considerations. I just think it's really unfair to force them to say, hey, you can't lay off anybody until things really get bad, and then you've got to prove it to us, and you know, and then we'll let you know if you're off the hook. I have a big problem with this. I come from a union household. I support unions. I'm all for collective bargaining and protecting the rights of workers. The state has passed some, I think, really meaningful pieces of legislation in recent years around wage theft and other areas that were sort of ambiguous. But this really, I think, could deal a death blow to the small business community in the fast food industry. And I would hate to see that. I would hate to see constituents of mine and more New Yorkers lose their jobs or lose job opportunities because of more burdensome regulations that we're putting on them. So, you know, I know that people had concerns and questions, but I did want to go on the record and state some of these things because I think that the intentions are good, but I think that the consequences of this definitely will be bad, especially when we do get into an economic downturn. And I just want to know, has the administration consulted with the chambers of commerce and the people who are actually functioning in these industries to get specific feedback on what their legitimate concerns are about these pieces of legislation? Has the administration engaged those stakeholders? And what type of engagement have they actually carried out? That's what I would like to know.
Mm-hmm. So I will say a couple of things in response. I mentioned earlier that from our own experience, just from the enforcement work that we do, we haven't seen any, we enforce the fair work week laws, right, which apply in the fast food and the retail industries. We haven't seen any employers come to us and say, I'm going to close because you're trying to enforce this law. And for those, the universe of businesses we've touched with through our enforcement, we haven't seen businesses or employers go out of business because of our enforcement work. I'm not familiar with the numbers you're just citing of 150
148 in the past 3 years, fast food establishments closing in New York City, just in New York City.
Mm-hmm. So, so I was just speaking from our own experience. We haven't seen that. I would say a couple of other things. Obviously, we're here at the hearing, and this is an opportunity to hear from the industry and to hear what are the challenges and limitations in having protections like these in place. With respect to automation, I think that's a separate thing that it's. I don't think that we can control that. But I think for the jobs that are still in existence, we should make sure that they are good jobs. So we'll be happy to continue to talk with the council to listen to the comments from the industry. But I can tell you that at least from the work that we've done enforcing the protections that are currently in place, it hasn't been an obstacle for the fast food industry to continue to do well.
I would like to see, and maybe at a later date, if there's an opportunity for the administration to have a meaningful and transparent public engagement process before, I know you've already signed on to supporting the bills, but before the bill is passed, if it is going to be passed, and before it's signed into law, so that those stakeholders, probably most of whom in the city are women and minority-owned businesses in particular, and they are struggling, okay? I would like to see a meaningful engagement to make sure that they absolutely have a seat at the table to make sure that when this legislation is passed, assuming that it will pass, that they're not shut out of the process completely. I've been in the council for almost 11 years, and I've seen instances where we've engaged the stakeholders on both sides in a good way, and I've seen bills passed in this body when one side was completely ignored. And I don't think that something as important as this is an area where the small business community should be ignored. I think engaging the chambers of commerce is a very good start in Brooklyn and Queens and the outer boroughs in particular, because that's where the bulk of these establishments are because of geography. But I think, and also the bids, I think through SBS, that there's an internal mechanism already in place for you to have an honest, thorough, and objective, maybe a survey or some sort of series of engagement town hall meetings where you can have them come and say, these are our concerns. This is how this legislation would impact our business. This is what we're really concerned about. I haven't heard a lot of their concerns mm-hmm. expressed, except through some of the advocates. So, and I actually had two McDonald's and Chipotle owners in my district reach out to me in advance of this hearing, send me a couple of emails. Happy to forward them over to you if you like. But these are legitimate people that have been doing business in the community for a long time. They employ lots of good people in the community. We want to support them. We want them to grow, turn a profit, hire more employees, and help revitalize our communities. I'm just very, very concerned about these bills, and I think that there was a rush to support it. And I hope that the administration independently will take it upon themselves, in light of what the mayor said at the State of the City, and have that meaningful engagement with the small business stakeholders and with the people who would be directly impacted by this legislation. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Orridge. Just on the council member's line of question, I have a kind of a hypothetical. In the situation that we have seen unfortunate automation, under these pretenses, is that something that we would evaluate in terms of justification, economic justification for termination? And how then would we address that?
I'd like to say possibly. I can't really give a definite answer on that. Do you have anything to add? Yeah, I think we'll have to go back and think about it some more. I'm not sure if that right now it's envisioned in the language that it would include something like that, something like automation, but we're open to thinking about it.
Yeah, in my travels throughout the district, throughout the city, that we've seen that, I've heard from workers, I've heard from business owners mm-hmm. that said that by virtue of some of the other policies that have come into effect, that they anticipated the savings because of this. Well, this was their way of kind of neutralizing some of the things that some of the policies. And so while we don't, certainly that's not the intent of any of the legislation, is to always uplift workers if in fact that there were unintended consequences. But we want to make sure that whether or not that was an unintended consequence or just merely a justification for an attempt to save money. And so it's something for us to look at in the past and how then in the future, but then how would we really be able to assess whether or not this was just a economic decision or mm-hmm. something otherwise, or something to think about. Mm-hmm. And then finally, I just want to ask, so you are comfortable that this is going to pass legal muster beyond implementation and as it pertains to federal policy and that we are not kind of overstepping boundaries?
I mentioned earlier that the law department is still reviewing the language, and obviously the goal is to make sure that the language is careful to avoid preemption challenges. But certainly even with legislation that has been thoroughly reviewed, in some cases we've ended up in litigation. So I cannot say that even we had the most perfect language that we wouldn't be sued. But I think that the law department is continuing to review the language and we'll be happy to discuss with council to make sure we have the strongest law in the books.
Thank you so very much for your testimony. Thank you again for your work and support of these workers and the partnership that you've demonstrated with the council for each for both of you and the agency that has provided the guidance, leadership, and oversight. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next panel. Jessica Walker. Keith Stevenson, Kathleen Riley,
I think our colleague might have stepped out for a moment.
Oh yeah, no, I'm sorry.
I don't know.
Do you provide testimony so we get a copy of that before they get started, so we can follow them? Okay, thank you very much.
All right, he's back in the room.
Is this Mr. Stevenson?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. It may begin.
I will. Good afternoon. My name is Jessica Walker. I'm the president and CEO of the Manhattan Chamber of Commerce. As you know, we represent the business community here across the borough. I'll spare you the, I'm not going to read line for line. But we're here today because we do strongly oppose these two bills. The legislation is singling out and needlessly picking on one industry, which is bad enough. But what's more is that what you are suggesting here is absolutely terrifying for most small businesses who fear that they may be the next targets of an expanded version of this dangerous legislation. First of all, I want to state very clearly that employers never want to eliminate jobs. There is no joy derived from laying off employees, and I say that because these bills do seem to be predicated upon the notion that employers everywhere are just firing people or laying them off with no strategic thought about the health of their business or the possible impact that it might pose on the employee, and that is false. It is never fun. But the reality is that sometimes a business has to make these tough decisions in order to thrive. And tying an employer's hands here could unfairly hurt the business. The process laid out in Intro 1396 does just that. It puts the onus on an employer to prove that layoffs are for bona fide economic reasons, as narrowly defined in the bill. If they do lay people off, it must be done by seniority, even if that means they will lose their best employees. They may be forced to go to arbitration, which is a time killer and takes away from their business, and the bill also opens them up to lawsuits. Intro 1415 is equally unworkable. It prohibits employee termination for reasons other than just cause. It forces businesses to use a very confusing disciplinary process to determine what rises to the level of their definition of just cause. And once again, employers may find themselves in timely arbitration or court as a result of the law. There are legitimate reasons for an employee's termination other than bona fide economic reasons or just cause as narrowly defined in this legislation. I want to give you an example. When a new member of the city council takes office, they rarely retain all of the staff of their predecessors. Why? It's hardly everybody economics or just cause. And those holdover employees certainly have more seniority than anyone new that's brought in. I ask you, would you want to spend your precious time sitting in arbitration for days in order to justify why you need to make staff changes? The answer is no. You want the best team surrounding you to help you move forward. And there is some subjectivity in that as an employer because you have a certain vision of what you want your workplace to feel like. You want all employees to get along and work well together. You want your employees to be on board with your agenda. And you may want greater strength in a certain skill sets that are lacking. Eroding an employer's ability to make these strategic staffing decisions is simply wrong. And it could be extremely damaging to a business. I give some examples here. You can suppress revenue. If I can't hire a better salesperson to replace the current salesperson who has mediocre skills, that can suppress my revenue. It can take very precious time away from the business to go to arbitration or court. It could suppress morale and productivity in the workplace if an unruly employee is allowed to stay on while I have to spend months in arbitration. It may force me to lay off someone I didn't want to simply because of seniority. This would be tying an employer's hand and taking away the critical, albeit hard choices that must be made to keep a business viable, which is already not an easy thing to do. Of course, all employers must adhere to anti-discrimination laws already in place that prohibit wrongful termination on the basis of any protected class or as retaliation. That is already current law, and employers should abide by that. Moreover, these bills could actually have a detrimental impact on employees. If it becomes next to impossible to discharge employees, then the hiring process will become that much more rigorous and biased, quite frankly. Employers will take fewer chances on candidates who are untested, who come unrecommended, or have even a hint of red flags, which will further shut out a whole swath of people who don't have a long work history and are simply trying to get their foot in the door to prove themselves. And so I think it would take us in the wrong direction of what I think we're all trying to do, which is to really try to open up the workforce and open up opportunity. So for these reasons, I urge the council to halt these bills. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kathleen Riley. I'm the New York City Government Affairs Coordinator for the New York State Restaurant Association. I will attempt to be brief. We have a little bit of longer written testimony as well, but just sort of hit the highlights for you. So we are here today also in opposition of introductions 1396 and 1415, and we will begin with 1396 because we have a few more straightforward sort of concerns with it. First and foremost, requiring a private business to prove something about its business condition to the city as a justification for making its own internal HR decisions feels like a really enormous overreach by the government. Beyond that, specifically, you're required to show the full or partial closing of operations or technological organizational changes to the business resulting, I'm emphasizing resulting, in the reduction in volume of production, sales, or profit. And the word resulting tells us that businesses will be forced to take a demonstrable hit to justify layoffs rather than practicing good business practices where you preempt harm to your business. You are forward-looking. You think about the trends, the potential future costs, whether it's your lease is going to be renewed, you see a minimum wage hike on the horizon, costs of your essential goods like ingredients are rising, and you preempt harm to your business. This would cause you to have a resulting damage before you're able to justify layoffs. Beyond that, our other main issue is that longevity of employment is not a good single indicator for conducting layoffs. There are a number of other factors that are not mentioned in the legislation that you are not allowed to consider when you're conducting layoffs. These can include what is your job description? What is your job performance? How essential or critical is the role that you play in that store? How able is your role to be consolidated with another role compared to maybe a role that the owner can pick up off hours to make up the slack? What are your intentions for moving forward with the company? For example, do you have managerial aspirations? We have a couple examples that we wanted to put forward because we really think that this ends up playing out in somewhat bizarre and unintended ways, and we just want to sort of put a little bit more of a face to it. If a business has 4 counter workers and 2 line cooks, they know they need the line cooks the most. The workers at the counter can likely have their work best consolidated. Unfortunately, the line cooks are the 2 newest and must be laid off first. Another business has recently hired an excellent counter worker. Unfortunately, rather than laying off the worker who comes in to clean part-time, which the owner could pick up instead, the excellent counter worker must be laid off first because she is newest. Another business recently hired a local mom who expressed interest in taking advantage of trainings and work up to a manager position. The operator is excited to have her on the team, and she's excited to be there. The operator also has a student on staff who has expressed plans to leave at the end of the summer when he goes back to school. In the meanwhile, he'll be unavailable for all weekend shifts because of another job he works. Unfortunately, the operator has to lay off the mom before the student, even though she had long-term hopes and was available for any shift because she is the newest. So that's sort of just to give a couple examples or any number of situations that could arise in which, in fact, pretty much every situation that arises in which an operator who needs to make layoffs is going to want to take the actual people that they employ and decide where they can do that best and causing the least harm. Furthermore, we just want to add that a reduction of hours in 15%, that equates to 6 hours of a 40-hour work week, which could easily be less than 1 full shift. As somebody else earlier mentioned, I think it was actually the commissioner, there's currently some lack of clarity about how long-term a reduction of hours would have to be to qualify. I don't know if the authors of the bill or the supporters of the bill have been personally schedulers for the fast food industry, but there are a lot of moving pieces there. And beginning to punish an operator over the discrepancy of potentially less than 1 full shift in any given week is punitive and it's unrealistic for the circumstances of the industry. I'd like to move on to intro 1415, which is just cause, and I think that one poses a more complicated set of challenges, and it's not nearly as clean cut to understand how an operator will be impacted by it and what concerns we may have. So allow me the time, if you will. Thank you. So first of all, we want to sort of return to a point that the Chairman Miller made. New York is an at-will state. At-will employment is the law of the land. At-will employment allows employers to both hire people as well as let people go at their discretion in order to accommodate their business needs. On the other hand, New York State has some of the best labor protections in the country, and it protects people from discrimination based on a protected class. It protects people from retaliation, especially retaliation for reporting something like a workplace wrong, like wage theft or sexual harassment. Actually, the commissioner mentioned that their ability to prosecute retaliation cases is both strong and successful in her testimony. That being said, we have heard a lot of the conversation around the need for legislation like this, and it has oftentimes featured anecdotes, which we are grateful to workers for sharing, about illegal workplace behavior that they've experienced. It typically goes something along the lines of, I reported wage theft to my manager and then my hours were cut. There's a reason why that should take a strong reaction from the crowd. It's because it's wrong and because it's illegal. But what we do not want to do as the industry, of course we want to hold bad actors accountable, we want to eliminate the behavior. What we don't want to do is take anecdotes about currently illegal behaviors and use them as a justification for legislating away at-will employment in this industry altogether. What we see as being consequences for legislating away at-will employment in this industry fall into three categories. One is related to hiring directly. As my colleague Jessica mentioned, if you are forced as the employer, based on limitations set upon you by the city, to consider any potential employee as the potential for a costly liability should something go wrong, it is going to change. That's a new lens with which you're looking at hiring. And it's going to cause you to be both risk averse and restrained in your hiring practices. As I'm sure everyone is familiar, and Jessica also mentioned, oftentimes the fast food industry is the first door that people knock on. It can employ people who might have barriers to other traditional means of employment, whether those be educational barriers, lack of job record, as Jessica mentioned, language barriers, any other number of barriers. As the current picture stands, the industry extends that hand of opportunity to people who might have a difficult time finding work elsewhere. If you take those same employers and you make it even riskier and potentially a costly and somewhat unbalanced arbitration risk to hire that person, they're going to have to seriously consider it and potentially decide not to do it at all. Which brings us to point two of automation. I know that the council is aware of automation and its trends. In fact, I know that this committee itself actually held a hearing about automation. And I'm aware that in that hearing about automation, the fast food industry was pointed out as a place where there's an especially high risk of job loss to automation. With that in mind, we find it especially ironic that the exact same industry be targeted to make it even more risky to hire human beings to perform workplace tasks. Obviously, this is the hospitality industry. People like the human element and the human warmth of hospitality. But if you take an operator and they feel that their hand is being forced into considering automation as a realistic alternative to hiring a new person, a new neighbor to work in their store, it's going to be another decision they have to think about very carefully. Which leads us to our third point, which is the idea that businesses will leave New York City altogether. I know that you can certainly still track down a fast food restaurant if you should want to, but as Councilmember Miller pointed out, there's been a net loss of 148 chain restaurants over the last 3 years. These are real trends that are taking place. It's a very realistic possibility. And if you're an operator who has currently been fighting for single-digit margins, you feel that you've been singled out and targeted for numerous pieces of legislation, some of which do not affect your other business peers, some of which do, and then yet another piece of legislation comes down the pipeline that is going to even additionally raise your risks and potentially raise your costs for hiring people, you might just decide to pack up and leave the city, and with you go the jobs, and the city will feel the impact. With all of that being said, those are sort of the bigger picture issues that we have with it. We also would like to discuss a little bit the mechanism and language issues.
Could you wrap up?
Yes. The mechanism. The employer has the burden of proof of proving that they had just cause. If a complaint is lodged, the employer is guilty until proven innocent. That is contrary to American justice. Vague language poses an issue, especially with the term egregious, which I know was used as an example earlier today. But if you're the business owner and you know you have the burden of proving that you followed the rules exactly, you're going to be put in a very difficult decision when you witness something that to you is egregious. Your personal investment is on the line, your brand is on the line, the safety of everyone in your store is on the line, but you know that your decision making is going to be verified by some third party who might disagree with the interpretation. All of that being said, we understand the intentions of the legislation. We understand the intention of protecting workers and making sure they have access to information and resources to right any workplace illegal acts that are taking place. Briefly, we would just suggest informational and resource-based campaigns. I don't know if anyone rode the subway anytime around the minimum wage hike, but you couldn't have not known about it if you tried. That's an example of something you could do, a subway informational campaign. Maybe it's an online resource base of giving people a step-by-step guideline of how to walk through a conversation like that with your manager. What do you need to document so that if you need future recourse, you have all of the right things? And last, maybe it's an access of a public fund, much like the defense fund that was recently created for people who are facing eviction. Thank you for your time. We are supportive of protecting workers and making sure they have access to the resources, but we do not feel that this is the right way to move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, council members of the committee. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to make this quick. My colleagues did a fantastic job really laying out the problems and our potential proposed solutions, which was really education, for all the reasons that Jessica and Kathleen mentioned. My name is Keith Stevenson. I'm director of the state and local government affairs on behalf of the National Restaurant Association. We're proud to say that we represent 10% of the nation's workforce. We're a very popular employer, and it's because we have a good product, and because we have good operators and managers and team members. It speaks volumes of the teams that we actually have and that we work with. I did submit extensive testimony focusing on diversity of our industry that was brought up many times today, and the opportunities provided by all restaurants, but in particular, quick service restaurants. With your permission, Mr. Chairman, I just want to read a couple statistics. I think folks would be really interested in hearing about the diversity of our industry. I'm going to make this very quick and then just touch on a couple points and I'm going to finish. 48% of industry employees are minorities compared to 36% across the rest of the economy. 25% of restaurant employees are Hispanic. 12% of restaurant employees are African American. 7% of restaurant employees are Asian. 3% of restaurant employees belong to more than one race. 40% of restaurant businesses are majority owned by minorities, compared to 29% of businesses across other sectors. 40% of managers and supervisors are minorities, more women and diverse leaders than any other category of the business community around the country. Now, those statistics suggest to me that we're doing a fantastic job recruiting the best people and helping them grow and training them to grow, whether it's in our industry or where they grow beyond our industry. So we're very proud of that. So I wanted to take a moment to tout that because I've heard a lot about the focus on diversity and minority interests, which we fully support. In fact, we're the industry of opportunity. I'd like to pose a few questions to Councilmember Lander. I might have missed other questions that were being raised, but when I walked in, you asked a number of questions, or you made a number of statements, I should say. I heard you say a number of times just how easy the recent myriad of labor laws have been on the restaurant industry to comply with. It really hasn't really harmed, or these are reasonable, so it's easy to absorb. I'm just curious to know how do you know that? Like, what statistics and what research are you referencing to know whether or not the laws that you've passed and supported recently have helped or have harmed? Above and beyond anecdote and I feel and I believe. That's number one. Number two, we represent 10% of the workforce. In other words, we represent every restaurant in New York City. You haven't come to ask us. You've never said, hey, Keith, thank you for meeting with me at the scheduling meetings. How is that law going? Have you guys done any research to determine whether or not it's helpful or harmful? That's disappointing. And then in fact, on top of that, I will say that you didn't reach out to us and talk to the restaurant community when you're drafting these bills. So it begs the question who you're talking to get this information, and we'd be happy to work with you in informing you about the restaurant industry, the opportunities provided, and how these laws that you're proposing without our input really does impact us, because we actually believe in our employees and we want these laws to be right. We don't want just them to pass because it's good policy because we feel like it. So here's what I can tell you. The myriad labor laws have hurt restaurants, small business in particular, quick service restaurants in particular, because they've been discriminated against for the past 5 years, and I'm sure you know all about that. The studies have shown, and I'd be happy to share them with you, and Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to share them with you, that they have hurt small businesses, quick service restaurants in particular. Their margins are so thin that this does harm employees, and what we have found is that it's reducing hours, And as a result, it's hurting wages for employees. Mr. Chairman, I hope that you'll take a look at the statistics and the testimony was submitted, because it'll really do a great job laying out who works for restaurants, in particular part-timers and teens, because that's a big portion of who the quick service industry hires. So a couple points. New York is an at-will state. The laws already exist. That's a great thing, because we want our employees to be protected. And she was talking about anecdotes that are being used about how employees are harmed. We'll probably hear some today, probably completely legitimate. And if they are, they should be investigated, and bad actors should be persecuted. But if you're not doing that, we don't feel like you should add another layer to business and then presume that they're wrong before enforcing your own laws or asking industry how it impacts them. All employers need flexibility. I love Jessica's example of when you come into office, that you want people that understand your philosophy, that have experience, that are going to represent you. Restaurant employees and employers are no different, and they should have the flexibility to do that. What these laws are essentially doing, these private entities, they take on all the risk, right? Private entities. They have to hire the staff, they have to sales and market, they have to educate their staff, keep their staff, develop a great product. They have to make money, and it's so slim and hard to do in this city. They're the ones that bear all the risk. But what you're doing in these laws is you're saying, you know what, that's not enough. What we're gonna do is we're gonna make the government your business partner, and we're going to tell you, even though we're not business operators, and even though we don't run restaurants and know how to do it, but we're gonna tell you what works best for your restaurant. Personally, I don't believe that's the role of government. I know our members don't believe that. And in instances where that's happened, it's had a more detrimental effect on the operator's employees than it's helped. So I'll pause there, Mr. Chairman. Thank you so much for the opportunity to present today.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for your testimony. I know that Councilmember Landa is eagerly awaiting a response, and Councilmember Adams also has some questions. But I just want to say that then that was pretty detailed, and part of your testimony was the lack of engagement with the business community when these policies are
yes, sir.
Adopted and so forth. And for the record, I know that some of you have been in the room for the working roundtable that this committee is moving forward on some ongoing legislation, right? So we kind of dismiss that we have not taken into consideration the impact on small business. And certainly, this is the Committee on Civil Service and Labor. And so our motto is, as Dr. King would say, that all labor has dignity, and that uplifts humanity, has dignity, and should be undertaken with painstaking excellence, which I'm sure these men and women do. But this legislation at its core is simply about dignity and transparency of whether or not when you terminate somebody, you're going to tell them why. Mm-hmm. I would hope that as we drill down on the rest of and obviously, you all have paid attention, looked at, and researched the legislation and based on your responses. But I think that there's also some opportunities for some engagement that if and when we move forward, that you would move forward as a participant. And that you can see where you see something, where you have some concerns about the bills, that those concerns can be mitigated, and that we can address any of your concerns as we move forward. That's what hearings are about, and that's why we're here to hear that as well. But ultimately, we want to make sure that the workers have the dignity and respect that they deserve. Some of the things, you know, we're here to hear. That's what this hearing is about. We're here to hear your concerns and certainly hear the testimony of the workers and as we move forward with the legislation. And so we want each and every one of you to be a part of that. And but that being said, I'm going to leave the questioning portion to Councilmember Lander and Councilmember Adams. Councilmember Lander.
Thank you, Chair Miller, and I appreciate all three of you being here today. And you know, I think despite some of what was said, we spent a lot of time before the Fair Work Week legislation. I met with dozens of employers. We amended that legislation. So, and I certainly don't think that all employers are evil. I value restaurant employers. I value fast food restaurant employers. You know, legislation is designed to protect people who are in the most vulnerable situations. And most employers would not fire someone without cause or without notice, but that doesn't mean the law shouldn't protect people so that they can't be. So, and I'm gonna try to take a deep breath. You know, Jessica and Kathleen, your testimony was extremely respectful. Keith, I don't know if your goal was to actually engage me in conversation, but coming in the way that you did didn't make me feel like it is, so just to be straightforward.
Sure.
But I'm gonna take a deep breath because I think the value here is to move forward with thoughtful legislation, and if we can learn from your testimony to do it, that will be valuable, even if you oppose it right on until the end. I do wanna take a step back because, you know, it is true that though I did a lot of meetings with fast food employers about the fair scheduling legislation, I've spent a lot more time over the last 5 years talking to fast food workers. And, you know, when I started talking to them, they were earning $7.25 an hour, which was the federal minimum wage. They got no advance notice of their schedules and were in very precarious scheduling. Many of them that I talked to were stuck in permanent, like part-time, involuntary jobs and had no pathway to full-time work. They did not have paid sick days, and each of those things was opposed just like you're opposing this pretty basic protection today. Like we were told, we can't have paid sick days because that'll make it impossible to operate businesses. We can't raise the minimum wage. We can't give people advance notice of their schedules. We can't offer people a pathway to full-time work. We did each of those things, three of them here, one in Albany. And yeah, I have continued to talk to both employers and to employees, and I'd be delighted. You know, we introduced this bill a year ago, so if there are employers that would like to come talk to me about it, I'd be delighted to hear. And if there are employers that would like to come talk to us about our Fair Work Week legislation, it's been thrilling to hear from workers who were stuck in involuntary part-time positions and have been able to get full-time jobs thanks to the access to hours provision. And because I have heard from a bunch of workers tell me how valuable that has been, and not one employer who have my phone number come and say, here's the harm that it did. That's the perception that I have on the set of laws we passed in the future, and honestly, it's the perception. So I guess I do want to ask a couple of questions first. I mean, you spoke about the things for which there's wrongful termination, and you're right, you're not allowed to discriminate, and you're not allowed to retaliate. But is it illegal to fire someone in a fast food restaurant or anywhere else for not smiling at their manager?
How widespread is that? I think that
did you read the report that said in which 65% of fast food workers who had been terminated were told they were not given any reason for the termination? Did any of you read that report?
I have seen it, and I think that, first of all, it's a small pool, right? I mean, it's like 500 people out of a 1,000.
500 people is a small survey?
It's a very small survey. Listen, I'm not going to dismiss anyone's experience. I do believe that if that's what somebody...
65% of 500 people is anecdote?
Of 500 people in a survey? Yes. I think, yeah, I'm not going to get in. I'm not going to... Okay. I'm not a researcher.
Depends
but
on
that
who's
is
being
very
surveyed
small
as well.
In a large industry. But listen, the issue here is that might be that person's experience, but how widespread is it that somebody...
I didn't ask how widespread it was. I mean, I have some statistics that say it is pretty widespread, and you say you don't believe them, but you don't have other statistics. But my questions are pretty simple because it is a question about what the basic protections are. And right now, it is not illegal in New York City for a manager in a fast food restaurant to fire someone because they like a different employee better and would rather give that person more hours, and so they fire the one they dislike. It's not illegal for a manager to fire an employee who they don't feel smiles enough. It's not illegal for a manager to fire an employee without any reason or cause or notice. Do you think that's right?
Can I address that?
Do you think it's right?
Yeah.
If you'll start by answering.
No, absolutely not. But here's the problem.
It's not right? Wait, it's not right.
Here's the problem that
we
have.
Then we got a lot of common ground.
Listen,
I just want to make sure I understood what you said.
But
it's not right?
But the devil's in the details here. The way you've written it is that means that
the way it works here is that
anything.
We get to ask the question. So I'm going to just finish asking this question.
Please.
I asked a question. I think you said absolutely not. I said, is it right that an employer could fire an employee for those reasons that I gave? And you think it's not right?
I don't think it's good business.
Okay, but I didn't ask.
I think it's an at-will state, so can it happen? Is it legal? Sure. Is it right? No.
All right, great. Then we have a lot of common ground to build from, because if you agree it's not right for someone to be able to be fired without cause or a good reason, then figuring out how we protect people from being fired without cause and good reason is what we're gonna do here.
Can I follow with a question to you?
Go ahead.
Okay. So let's say that that doesn't happen. Okay, under the new rule, the way we read it, it looks good on the surface. So your intention of your bill is good, but when you read the details in terms of how definitions are spelled out and the amount of, all the onus is in the employer, here's what I would argue back. I would argue back that, let's say the employer said that happened, right? Or the employee said that happened and the employer didn't do it. Under these laws, the way they're drafted, basically, all the power would go to the employee to make that argument, and the employer could be sued.
So this is actually a great conversation I want to continue on, because I actually think we can drill down and make some improvements to the legislation and work with you, because, you know, I think you would have to have a different reason. You know, if the employer fired an employee, and the employee said, I mean, obviously, it'd be pretty unlikely that the employer would give a reason which was like, I liked your friend better, or you didn't smile at me. But if they didn't give any reason, then you're right, they would have been violating the law. Now, you gave two reasons in your testimonies, which I actually think were not bad reasons. You gave the example of a salesperson. It's a little different because I don't know that we have the same kind of salespeople as you were imagining in fast food restaurants,
sure.
Who had mediocre skills at sales.
Yes.
So that is absolutely a reason why, you know, if you hired someone, now this bill has a probationary period, and if they weren't doing well, you could fire them without cause during the probationary period. But let's say they got past the probationary period and their sales were mediocre. You had an employee whose sales was mediocre, what would you do?
I don't mean necessarily, first of all, I don't know that that would reach just cause in the way that it's laid out in this bill, just because maybe sales are up 20%. I meet somebody who's like amazing, who I know comes very well recommended, and they're going to increase my revenue 50%. That would not rise to just cause under this bill.
I guess you're right. If a fast food manager was going to fire an employee because they believed a new person that they could hire with their bright smile might sell more Big Macs, you're right that I don't think it would be a just cause.
This is not laughable. This is.
I agree.
I'm telling you.
I'm talking about trying to protect workers from being fired without any reason at all.
I am representing the small business community here because there is a fear, and you said it yourself in your opening statement that you do want this to go to all industries.
I do.
That's frightening. And so I think that is a real life example. We're not talking about just Big Macs here.
So then I'm happy to come back to the salesperson. Wouldn't you, if you were the employer of a salesperson who wasn't doing well enough, provide them some notice, indication, verbal, you know, opportunity? You give them a verbal warning. You give them a written warning. You say, here's the targets that you need to hit to succeed in this job. Like, isn't that what you do with your employees?
Yes, but it doesn't have to be uniform in terms of what is here.
I'm happy to work with you on the language, because one good example is the thing that would be best would be as if a workplace developed a set of protocols that made clear what good success, what you have to do to succeed in the job.
Those are best practices that don't necessarily need to be enshrined in law.
So
that they can
all
be sued,
we can have,
and have to be in arbitration.
So the only choices are to leave workers entirely vulnerable to firing without any notice, any reason, or any warning.
I think
or
you're generalizing.
Or hope we have employers who have best practices. Is that what you're saying?
So I think you're way oversimplifying it, right? The reality is, in the market system, if I have a business and I don't hire the right team or offer the right product or service, I go out of business, right? So it's up to me as an employer to do the right thing. Based on your examples, look, do they have the right? Is it unlawful for them to fire? No, it's not unlawful. Are they going to keep good employees? Are they going to be able to attract new employees? Is their business going to grow? No, they'll go out of business, right? I'm not suggesting there shouldn't be a modicum of safety. What I'm suggesting is,
are you going to propose? Just to be clear, you absolutely are suggesting there should not be
a modicum of safety. That there's going to be in rules a 1,000-page diatribe on what represents good and bad behavior? Because that's what you're doing.
I really apologize if you think that a 1,000-page diatribe is what we're at here, when what we're talking about is responding to a set of workers who currently can be fired without notice, without warning, or without cause. And if you're going to come in with that attitude and think it's going to then say, oh, you didn't meet with us a lot. Anyway.
It doesn't make a difference. Hey, what this doesn't say is what represents a proper progressive process through which an employer could use to give notice
if
and documentation.
If you would like to give us some feedback on what you think a good progressive progress is, we'd be delighted to have it. If you'd like to give us feedback on what you think good reasons are that it's appropriate for people to be terminated, we would love to have it. If you would like to give us feedback on how employers and employees can understand what the expectations of a job are so that vulnerable workers can know what they are, can show up and do their jobs in businesses that they are trying to help without fear of being fired without warning or cause or reason, we would be delighted to have it. There is room for us to work with you guys to improve this, to make sure that people can comply. But if what you're going to continue to say is it must stay the right of employers to terminate people at their own discretion with no notice, with no warning, and with no reason, then I don't think that you should expect for us to get to a same place together. So I'm going to close my questioning just because we've got a lot of people that we want to hear from. But I guess one thing, I would love to see the data about business closures, because I was looking online and actually it looks to me like businesses, restaurants other than fast food are actually closing at rates faster than fast food restaurants. Obviously increasing rents and a whole range of other causes are in place. And I think there is zero evidence that the provisions that we have made to make sure fast food workers have some dignity have led to any of those closures at all. And I guess finally, threatening that automation is a reason for people to accept jobs with less dignity, fast food employers are going to replace workers with automation when they believe it is in their economic interest to do so. And, that has downsides for sure, but that's what happens in the economy. And if McDonald's believes that, those automated touchscreens can reduce workers in an amount that makes sense for them economically, they're going to do it. But asking the workers who remain to be vulnerable because they fear being replaced by machines is not a good way for us to build an economy that's got dignity for people.
I'm sorry, if I may just respond to the automation question. The point was actually more that in an at-will state where the vast majority of all workers are at will, the ability to be let go without notice or at the employer's discretion is an almost universal situation. I know all my colleagues and I are in the same position as well. And the point was actually more—
I would love to see you guys also protected from unfair firings, just to be clear.
From unfair firings? Everyone is protected by state labor law.
No, you're not. You're protected from a discriminatory firing, and you're protected from a firing in retaliation for your rights. You're not protected from a firing without a reason whatsoever. If your boss,
I'm fairly confident that my contract states that I work at the employment
at the will of the employer.
At the will of my employer.
Yep.
The point is, I'm sorry. Can I please? I just wanted to finish the point. The point is just that when all jobs outside of collective bargaining agreements are at-will jobs, to target the same industry that the council has already acknowledged is especially at risk for automation, to target that industry for their jobs to become riskier to fill with people seems counterintuitive. That was the point about automation, just to clarify.
Agreed. Well said.
May I say one thing? Two points. One is, I invite all of you to engage and do some town hall meetings with small business owners. It is not their experience that there's been no pain. I think all along in all of these different policies, we've said not that you can't do them, but if you do them, there will be pain, there will be consequences. And I think that we have seen some of that. You can just look at storefront closures. I mean, there's a lot of things that are happening there that I think should be discussed. That's number one. Number two, I just want to give a policy matter that I've been trying to push for a while now, which is the city council really should adopt a system to study the economic impacts of legislation before they're passed so that you do have a clear understanding of how it's going to affect jobs, small businesses, the economy, and that's just putting three really, really good economists in the in your fiscal bureau and to be able to look at these bills so we don't have to go off of 30-party research and talk about how what their pool size is and what is, you know. This would be something that would be unbiased, that everybody could see, and then we can make some of those decisions.
Well, we thank you for that. And from this committee's perspective, as I said, I think transparency is it really translates into dignity for the workers. And we've kind of taken it to another level when we start talking about the economic impact of it and whether or not you can. And I don't think that is the intention, that we want to put any business under, and that we are, as Councilmember Landon said, that we are willing to address any concerns that you may have that may lead to real economic impacts. But the fact of the matter is that we are really trying to bring dignity to the most vulnerable. And as you mentioned, that there potentially that there are folks who are working at will, but statistically, these are the most vulnerable, but also the most impacted. And so that's why this particular legislation addresses this target audience here. Thank you so much for your testimony.
Thank you.
Next panel. Patricia Smith. Alicia Patterson. Is that Patterson? Hope Gozo. David Cohen. Okay, you can begin your testimony. Please identify yourself and press the red button.
Thank you. My name is Patricia Smith. I'm currently of counsel to the National Employment Law Project. I'm a former commissioner of labor here in New York, and I was the U.S. Solicitor of Labor during the Obama administration. And I'm testifying in support of the pair of bills. They would set some minimum standards for termination in the fast food industry. Now, industry opponents have objected, saying that such standards are unprecedented, that they would stifle business. But in fact, there is extensive precedent for minimal standards, often called just cause standards, in the United States and around the industrialized world. Just cause for discharge is the norm in Europe, and in many Canadian provinces, it is also the norm for all workers. You already heard about Philadelphia last year, which is also has also adopted this, and the state of Montana also has it. And in New York, and really around the country, there are well-established legal standards for what just cause employment looks like. Now, they've been developed primarily in the context of unionized workforces, but the standard is often, very often, in the contracts of CEOs and other executives who are given lavish severance payments when they're fired, unless the firing is for just cause. So what is this just cause standard that businesses are afraid of? There is actually a gold standard out there for just cause employment. It was developed in 1964 by a professor, Dr. Daugherty. And this standard is still commonly used and widely accepted both by arbitrators and courts. So the principles generally correspond to the principles in the bill, but I'd like to go into them to show you exactly how common sense they are and really not difficult to implement. The first is notice. An employee must have adequate notice of rules and expectations, Now, exceptions obviously can be made for certain conduct, which is so serious that the employee is presumed to know that it's punishable. Second, the orders and the rules must be reasonable. They must not be arbitrary. They must be reasonably related to the efficient and safe operation of the employer's business. Third, there must be an investigation, and the employer has to make a sufficient effort to discover whether the employee did or did not violate a rule of management. Fourth, the investigation has to be fair. It's got to be fair and objective. Fifth, there has to be proof. There must be some evidence of guilt. Now, this standard is not as high as the standard in the courts or in civil cases, but the employer must have some real evidence, not just guesses. Sixth, equal treatment. The rules, the orders, the penalties, they have to be applied even-handedly without discrimination. If enforcement has been lax in the past, management can't suddenly reverse its course. It has to warn employees that it's now going to start to enforce these rules before it does it. Finally, the penalty has to be reasonable. The discipline, including discharge, has to be reasonably related to the seriousness of the offense and the person's past record. So ensuring that workers receive notice, a good reason, and fair process before losing their jobs protects families, it protects communities, it's a good human resource policy. It is not difficult to implement. One last thing I'd like to talk about. I've heard the people representing businesses talking about the difficulties of arbitration, the horrors of possible horrors of arbitration, which I have to tell you that one of the things that I work on is the tendency of employers now to force employees into arbitration. And one of the things that I think is very important in this bill is that arbitration is voluntary. It is not forced. So on the one hand, we hear employers saying arbitration is a bad thing. On the other hand, what we see is a trend that employers are choosing arbitration where they want their employees to go. Finally, I've been around labor law a long time. I've been in a lot of these testimonies around the country, in New York State, the United States Congress, here. And one thing, when worker protections are proposed, you hear, and I know it's legitimate, you hear fear from the business community. You are always hearing, we may have to close down, this is going to stifle our business, we're going to lose jobs. I think we have to look at the evidence, as we've been saying, in the past of what happens. This is not a bill which, unlike raising the minimum wage or requiring paid sick days, actually imposes an economic cost. Yes, employers are going to have to learn just cause discharge, which is not that difficult, which has been around for a long time, which there are many resources, but it's just about a fair process. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Chair Miller and other members of the Committee on Civil Service and Labor. My name is Alyssa Peterson. I'm a Lyman Fellow for Worker Justice at the Center for Popular Democracy. Together with the National Employment Law Project, Fast Food Justice, and SEIU 32BJ, we conducted the survey that the business community had issues with. I'm happy to talk more about the survey. I primarily, in my role at CPD, I've worked on issues that Tricia mentioned of forced arbitration and also implementing Fair Work Week policies around the country. I'm here to present testimony from Ana Maria Archila, who serves as the co-executive director at CPD. So CPD is a high-impact national organization that builds organizing power to transform the local and state policy landscape. We do this work through having deep and long-term partnerships with leading community-based organizations nationwide, and the victories of fast food workers in New York City is a perfect example of what can be accomplished through this approach. Here in New York, fast food workers have organized to win $15 minimum wages and brought about Fair Work Week policies. So in this context, each of these victories have moved fast food workers further toward the goal of transforming the industry, but that goal is always going to be undermined until workers have just cause protections and can be fired, because at present they remain at-will employees and they can be fired at any time without explanation. In the context of working with our affiliate organizations at Make the Road or at New York Communities for Change, we often talk to workers who toil under the constant fear that they could be fired at any time for any reason. And that a termination could leave their family push them into homelessness, force them to drop out of school, or otherwise disrupt their economically fragile lives. So together with NELP, SEIU 32BJ, and Fast Food Justice, we issued a report last year that found out of a survey of 539 New York City fast food workers that 50% of them had been fired, laid off, or compelled to quit a job due to intolerable working conditions. 65% of these workers reported that they were denied even a basic explanation when they were terminated. So this is not an issue where it's a one-off smiling. This is a systemic problem in the industry where workers are terminated possibly for discriminatory or other illegal issues, but they have no opportunity to challenge the circumstances of their termination. And as we know, this workforce is already incredibly vulnerable. Two-thirds of fast food workers are women, two-thirds are immigrants, and 88% are people of color. So this, combined with a threat of dismissal and a business model that tolerates exceptionally high turnover rates, contributes to a proliferation of abusive employment practices. Other findings of our report were that 90% of fast food workers experience wage theft, 78% of them have been injured on the job, 73% had experienced burns, and 40% of women had experienced sexual harassment. And again, as Tricia is saying, despite employers' objection to arbitration in this context, when it's about equally parties with equal power, employers have been using forced arbitration to make it impossible for workers to vindicate their rights when they experience these abusive working conditions. So many of these abuses are prohibited by our laws, but when employers can fire workers on a whim without giving reasons, that is frees them to discriminate against workers and retaliate against those who stand up for their rights. So in sum, we strongly support this Just Cause legislation. The legislation incorporates ideas that we take for granted, that it's unfair to punish someone who had no way to know about a policy. It's unfair to discipline people who have similar behavior as other workers, but the policy is applied unevenly. And it also requires employers to conduct objective and fair investigations and to have some proof when they confront workers with allegations. These are pretty basic principles within our democracy. They're principles that white-collar workers, even if we are at-will employees, assume in our workplace. It's only fair that these principles are also extended to low-wage workers in the fast food industry. And then, and additionally, to prevent employers from exploiting loopholes in the law, 1396 would also make sure that employees are protected against layoffs without a bona fide economic reason. So essentially, these bills are about addressing severe power imbalances in the industry, and they'll bring more stability and security to the more than 67,000 fast food workers. So as representing CPD today, I stand strongly with these workers and ask that you give them their strongest possible support. Thank you.
Thank you, David Cohen of 32BJ, reading our President Kyle Bragg's testimony. And thank you, Chair Miller and committee members, for holding this important hearing today. Intros 1396 and 1415 will give fast food workers the just cause protections, as we've heard from the previous two speakers, from arbitrary firings, cuts in hours, and layoffs. And as I just continue, Kyle's unfortunately had to leave a little bit earlier, so I'm gonna read on his behalf. These bills are going to give workers the respect that they deserve, and we'll hear from some workers after this. We're submitting also over a dozen worker testimonies, testimony from 32BJ members, testimony from 32BJ supporters, as well as all the advocates you're here from as well. But the industry itself, you know, the management practices treat workers as disposable commodities, and you know, the reports that CPD mentioned, which was co-authored with NELP among and others, found that 50% of those workers are losing their jobs on unjust terms. So thank you again for reiterating the importance of that report. The workers who've suffered these practices, and again, you'll hear from them, are working for companies worth billions of dollars, but their managers see fit to fire the workers on a whim or reduce their hours or point out that they can't make enough to survive. No one should be treated like this when going to work, and that's why we're here today. Workers should at least be able to expect that if they're doing something wrong on the job, their boss will let them know and give them a chance to improve it. It's also responsible for workers to expect that their company does face bona fide economic headwinds, that their years of service will be recognized in the order that any layoffs occur. And I, again, want to thank the lead sponsors, Council Members Landers and Adams, for recognizing, you know, these important issues. So I think we've talked about what fast food workers have gained, $15 minimum wage, The City Council passed fair scheduling laws that are so important and create workplace protections. Even with these advances, though, the threat of a downward economic spiral remains for fast food workers when their employers are able to fire them, cut their hours without any legitimate reason. So I ask again that you listen to the stories of fast food workers and please review the testimonies that we've submitted in writing. And I also want to really talk about the importance of enforcement around all these pieces, both paid sick and fair scheduling. If we're going to be able to both enforce the existing statutes and future statutes here, we need strong resources and support for agencies charged with that enforcement. So again, we ask the council to support adequate resources for the Department of Consumer and Worker Protection. And on the arbitration issue, and there's certainly others who can speak to this, enforcement is so important, and arbitration may be a preferred option because of, a lack of appeals at oath. The way that the enforcement is done administratively, we might need another option to better protect workers, and that's what we're here advocating for. So again, you'll hear from so many workers today who need these protections. We'll hear from other advocates, and want to thank you again for the time and leadership for holding this hearing and giving workers a chance to speak and get these workplace protections.
Thank you. Thank you all. And I think there's a couple of questions that we have here. There was some questions around implementation and some of the concerns, obviously, that the business community had and that they expressed. And I don't know if there was demonstrated really the desire to really engage and kind of work through this legislation that we were hoping to see. But from our esteemed panel and some from by virtue of their expertise, perhaps we can look a little further into the legislation that would make it more palatable, not just to the business folks, but to ensure some of the things that David just mentioned about enforcement, whether or not we had the arbitration panel as well. A distinguished panelist has said to us earlier that there has been much concern that has actually, I know in the committee there is there's a resolution that addressed forced arbitration, which is a problem that we've seen nationally and that certainly that we've seen here. One of the other things that concerns me and that I'd like to hear from the panel is obviously there's an emphasis on the fast food industry, but there's a lot of concern of at-will and termination, even within white collar, that we see right here in New York City, that we've held hearings on that as well. And so certainly this is a prelude to address holistically what we see is something that has not been fair and transparent to all workers here in the city of New York, and so I'd like to talk about that. But specifically, are there any other industries or any industries that you know of where just cause termination, that there are standards that we should talk about and that we are looking to address or duplicate here through this legislation?
If I could talk about arbitration for a minute. One of the problems with forced arbitration is that it's often in the allegation is wage theft, and frankly, arbitrators are not necessarily wage hour investigators, but one thing that arbitrators do know is just cause employment, because it is in every union contract. So some of the concerns about arbitration, about arbitrators not understanding various aspects of the labor law, are not at issue when you're talking about just cause arbitration, because that is almost the number one thing, especially in union context, that they will be dealing with in their arbitrations. So I just want to make that distinction between, and again, in this particular instance, you do have voluntary arbitration, you don't have forced arbitration, so people can make their decisions. I'm not sure I can talk about other industries, maybe my other panelists can.
I guess I can quickly speak to the other industries insofar as if Fair Work Week is a potential model that we'd want to replicate here, because Fair Work Week is about identifying employers who have the means to implement policies and practices consistently across the industry. So I know in other Fair Work Week laws in other jurisdictions, there's retail, there's hospitality, there's nursing homes. So there's other states are sort of experimenting with, again, the type of corporate actors who do have strong control over the franchisees. That could be another group of industries that would also be of interest.
Yeah. And Mr. Chairman, just speaking again for the fast food workers who are here today, I think, you know, a year ago, there were 100 fast food workers outside on the steps to introduce the bill, or 100 workers here today. And, you know, many years ago, they started fighting for a $15 minimum wage. In 2017, we passed a Fair Work Week. So I think I can speak to the need that fast food workers have just been organizing intensely, both advocating with the leadership of the Council for Workplace Protections, but also in Albany, and also in the streets, and calling on employers to do the right thing. I think, you know, we see Just Cause for fast food workers as something that's close, because the workers are demanding it, and we hope that you will agree with that.
So I'm going to take a point of personal privilege as the chair here and talk about something that myself and other members of the committee and the council have addressed and adopted as we work on uplifting workers and protecting the rights of workers. And that is a philosophy that the best way to do that is to support the right to collective bargaining and support the right to organize, right? And that has been vital, right? And that obviously, know my history, who I am, and that the upward mobility, not just of myself, of those that we represent, that has been achieved through those things. And so that is something that we like for all workers to have. And so oftentimes our this body, in lieu of that, ends up doing this. And so so as related to this legislation and respects that we've seen, and particularly in the fast food industry and low wage workers, you know, whether it is an attempt to organize or that has occurred in the past or as we move forward, how do we address this as we move forward in terms of policy actions and feasibility to pursue policy that address this, but also supports the ability and the rights to organize in here? Because as I look at workers, I see an excitement in those who are willing to come out each and every day in all these instances that you just mentioned, and be supportive of these initiatives and protests and policy changes. How do we then translate that into the ability to organize and collectively bargain? Because that then, you know, allows this council to do the business of the council, which right now is this. But those folks who do it best, where are they in this? Where are they in this fight? And I see Bert 32BJ, but and I recognize this is a partnership, but you get it to a certain point and you kind of handing it off to the council, right? So this is a long-term plan and how we do, because there are a lot of workers. There are less than 15% of workers that are represented throughout the country now. And so I don't know if the appetite of legislatures and legislative bodies throughout the country have the same commitment as this New York City Council, right? So in lieu of that, what do we do?
So if I could sort of maybe address that a little bit. Just a few weeks ago, a major report came out of Harvard. It's called The Clean Slate for Workers' Rights, and it was hundreds of labor folks academics came together to reimagine what labor law would look like to make it easier for workers to collectively bargain. And one of the suggestions was that just cause for discharge be adopted. And the reason was that even though, and we've talked about, you know, there are retaliation provisions, that one of the major things that does hamper organizing is people's fear of being fired. And that if there were just cause provisions, it would actually enhance the ability to collectively bargain. So while the City Council obviously cannot rewrite the National Labor Relations Act, as this proposal does, it may well be that by passing just cause discharge, you actually do enhance a worker's ability to collectively bargain. And I do recommend, just for reading the clean slate, it has lots of proposals, but that was the one that struck me about just cause discharge and the connection with collective bargaining.
And thank you, and we have also some of our, one of our councils is here who could speak to this, and I also want to say on behalf of 32BJ and our president, that we fully respect also, Chairman, where you come from and all the work that you've done, and you know, I think where 32BJ is on this, and I think if we fully support fast food workers who are fighting just cause, fighting for just cause protections here legislatively in the council, and we fully support fast food workers' right to collectively bargain, you know, to really to create the situation and circumstances that you're in. So we support both those things, and we don't see them as mutually exclusive. Just wanted, you know, so I wanted to actually check with the council first, but I think we're okay. Okay.
Councilmember Landa? You're good? Councilmember. Thank you so very much for your time. Look forward to continuing to work with each and every one of you, and look forward to that reading. And we'll call the next panel. Thank you. Gavin Green, Rent, Terrell Martinez, Carmelo Polacco, Jeremy Espinal, and Melody Walker. Good afternoon. Welcome to the People's House. Look forward to hearing your testimony. No steel coats in.
Good afternoon. Yes.
One person's missing, but you can start, Ms. Walker. Press the red button, please.
Sorry.
There you go. Thank you. Now the world can hear you.
Good afternoon. My name is Melody Walker. I worked at Chipotle store at 55th Street and 3rd Avenue for a little under a year until I was fired without just cause in August of 2017. My story explains why you need to pass this bill into law. I'm a single mom. I have two daughters, age 8 and 17. When I started at Chipotle, I was working 23 hours a week before being moved up to regularly work between 30 and 35 hours. I did my job well and made sure I arrived early for my shifts. I was hopeful that it would be a stable job with an income I could support my family with. Things changed when a new manager took over the store. He cut existing workers' hours including mine, while bringing on new workers from other stores. It seemed clear to me that he was trying to drive out workers who had been at the store before he arrived. My hours were cut as low as 8 hours per week. Things were so bad that I had to go on unemployment while I was still working. It is crazy that anyone should have to get public benefits while working for a company that makes billions of dollars a year. When I was fired, it happened on the spot during a shift. The manager told me that I was not smiling while I was at the counter. I was shocked. There were not even customers in the store at the time. If this law had been in place and my manager acted as he did, I would have had the right to challenge my hours being cut and my firing. Instead, I had no protection. It took me months to get another job and put my family's life back on track. I had to get public assistance again to help pay my bills. I don't want anyone to have to go through what I did. I ask to you to support this bill and give fast food workers protection again against unfair treatment. Thank you.
Good evening at this point now, right? Committee Chairman Miller and committee members, my name is Gavin Florence, and until recently I worked at Chipotle Mexican Grill. I am here to say that workers like myself need protection provided in the Just Cause legislation that we introduced almost a year ago in the City Council. On November the 6th, I was returning from holiday, scheduled to work when my flight was delayed. I called my assistant general manager and told him that I was going to miss my shift. He told me it was fine and that he had found another coworker to cover my shift. The next day, November the 7th, Chipotle emailed me telling me that I was fired. I was shocked. Immediately, I called my general manager, who told me that he fired me because I missed my shift without giving notice, a no-call, no-show. He said the assistant GM never told him that I called ahead and that his failure to communicate this was my fault. Even if I had missed my shift without giving notice, Chipotle does not consistently terminate workers for this offense. I know several co-workers who have done a no-call, no-show multiple times without punishment. Since being fired, I've struggled to pay my rent and tuition towards graduate school where I'm studying law. We've had lots of talk about arbitration. My unfair termination by Chipotle has set me back financially. Under the Just Cause legislation, Chipotle would never have been able to use an inconsistently enforced rule to fire me. If they disputed the facts of my case, I would have access to fair arbitration system to resolve my employment status. Instead, I am worried about losing my housing. Right now, fast food workers have few protections against capricious managers. We need Just Cause. Committee members, I ask that you support this legislation and stand with us as we ask the council to pass it into law. Thank you.
And yeah, sorry. I'll just be providing translation for Gerald. He'll read it one time through in Spanish, and then I'll read his statement in English.
Okay. Good afternoon. Mi nombre es Gerald Martínez. Buenas tardes, presidente del comité Miller y miembro del comité. Trabajé en Chipotle en la tienda 4009 de Robert más de 3 años antes de que me despidieran en octubre del 2019. Durante este tiempo, creo que experimenté varias cosas que no debieran de suceder en el lugar de trabajo, como por ejemplo, está mal pagado por turno y no recibir pago por hora extra, trabajando más de 40 horas a la semana. También estaba claro que para mí, que los gerentes estaban decididos a evitar que los trabajadores hablaran entre sí sobre su derecho. Uno de los gerentes incluso me llegó a decir a mí que Chipotle paga mucho impuesto a la ciudad para poder hacer lo que quieran con los empleados y que a nadie le importa sobre lo que me pasara a mí o a uno de mis compañeros. Me despidieron el día después de que llamé enfermo por dolor de espalda. El dolor había comenzado al comenzar mi turno anterior. Intenté dejar el trabajo cuando comenzó el dolor, pero los gerentes no me dejaron así, que tuve que terminar mi turno. Cuando me despidieron, le dije que a mi gerente que estaba mal y que había un usado, que yo tenía ahora una semana de vacaciones y días de enfermedad que lo podía usar. El gerente lo que me dijo es que no importaba que yo tuviera esos días, que como quiera yo estaba despedido. Antes de despedir mi trabajo, vivía en un... Antes de perder mi trabajo, yo vivía en un apartamento. Yo no podía seguir pagando el apartamento. Terminé viviendo en un shelter. Nadie quiere vivir así. Tuve que mudarme con mi esposa y mi hijo en un shelter. Yo me estaba a punto de mudar incluso cuando me despidieron. Después de que me despidieron, pude afirmar el papeleo para mudarme. He estado buscando trabajo desde que me despidieron y todavía todavía estamos viviendo en un shelter y todavía no he conseguido trabajo. Necesitamos que se aprueben esta ley. Los trabajadores de comida rápida tienen miedo de ser despedidos y no poder cuidar a nuestra familia, y tenemos demasiado miedo de tomarnos un tiempo libre. Le pido que apoyen esta ley. Demuestren que a Nueva York le importa cómo la empresa tratan a su empleado. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Committee Chair Miller and committee members. My name is Gerald Martinez. I worked at Chipotle store at 4009 Broadway for over 3 years before I was fired in October 2019. During this time, I believed I experienced a number of things that shouldn't happen in the workplace. Being underpaid for shifts and not getting paid overtime when I worked more than 40 hours in a week. It was also clear to me that the managers were determined to stop workers from talking to one another about their rights. One of the managers even said, "Chipotle pays a lot of taxes to the city to do whatever it wants to the workers, and no one cares what Chipotle does to you or your coworkers." I was fired the day after I called out sick due to back pain. The pain had started on my previous shift. I tried to leave work when the pain started, but the managers wouldn't let me leave. When I was fired, I told the manager that it was wrong and that I had paid sick time and vacation time that I could have used. The manager said they didn't care, they had already fired me, and didn't need any reason to fire me. Before I lost my job, I was living in an apartment, and because of losing my job, I ended up having to move into a shelter. I was also in the process of trying to move out and find another apartment. After I was fired, I couldn't sign the paperwork to move in. I have been looking for work since I was fired, and we're still living in a shelter. We need these laws to pass. Fast food workers are afraid of being fired and being unable to care for our families, and we're too afraid to take any time off. Please support these bills and show us that New York does care how companies treat their workers. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for your important testimony, and continue to tell your story and know that this council is supporting your efforts. Thank you. We're going to call our next and final panel. Angeles Salas, Zuban Soleimani, Sean Richmond, Could you just push the red button there?
Now you can hear me? Okay, I sound great. Good afternoon, Chair Miller and members of the committee. My name is Angeles Solis. I'm the lead organizer of the Workplace Justice Team at Make the Road New York, and we are in unwavering support of the Just Cause legislation. Make the Road New York builds the power of 23,000 working class and immigrant members across five boroughs to achieve dignity and justice for workers, tenants, immigrants, youth, and more. Every single day, immigrant workers come through our doors with stories of exploitation, wage theft, harassment, discrimination, injuries on the job in unsafe conditions, but also stories like the ones that are being described today, being let go over arbitrary reasons that make no sense. If you ask workers what holds them back from speaking up, it is overwhelmingly the fear of being fired. For many of our membership, this is compounded by the fear that management can fire them, cut hours, and often use their immigration status to threaten workers, especially those who do speak up. Employers in the industry must do better, must be held accountable, and if there is a strong reaction that to a basic commitment to provide valid reasons for termination, that should indicate to the council the urgency of why we all need Just Cause. The fast food industry has enabled a culture of fear and instability for thousands of its employees because of the at-will model. It puts at risk thousands of hardworking people in our communities, people working to put food on the table for their own families. One of those people is Juana. Juana was a member leader in the Fight for 15, and I'll share her story briefly on her behalf. She worked the morning shift at McDonald's from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. She picked up her daughter at daycare by 3 p.m., dropped off at her sister's just to go back at work at a Wendy's for the night shift. She would get back around 10 p.m. And crawl into bed with her sleeping five-year-old because that was, to her, according to her, the few moments of the day that she had with her daughter. She would often share stories of panic attacks due to her manager's verbal abuse, of needing to walk into the bathroom, lock the door, breathe, splash water on her face, because of the abusive conditions on the job that not only her, but her coworkers faced. She talked often about feeling like she was walking on eggshells at work, and mind you, she'd been in fast food for over 10 years. She spoke often of the fear that any small mistake could cost her a job. These conditions are precisely the ones Just Cause will address. Juana worked two fast food jobs, because she had a daughter to support, a daughter who needed to see her be strong. Her story is just one of many in an industry that is majority staffed by women, immigrants, and people of color. Any failure to enact Just Cause is a failure to support a vulnerable workforce of primarily black women, brown women, immigrants, and people of color. The New York City Council has an opportunity to enact life-changing legislation for 67,000 people and their families, and we're here to ensure it will happen. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sean Richmond. I'm the program director of the Harry Van Arsdale Jr. School of Labor Studies at the State University of New York. Just Cause is an employment standard, an employment right across the industrialized world. It's not just France. But the idea that they can't fire you for no reason or bad reason is found, it's throughout Africa, throughout Asia, it's enormously common. The at-will standard, the at-will law that the industry was referring to, is not a law that anyone ever voted on. It was an invention of 19th century judges. And arguably, and I do make this argument, the Constitution was amended twice to give people more protections throughout society, but judges have disagreed. Like much of our system of worker representation, the general sort of acceptance of at-will is an accident. When unions represented 1 in 3 workers, non-union firms tried to match union standards in pay and benefit, but also they behaved with a little bit of decency around terminations. 40-plus years into a sustained corporate assault on unions, with union density hovering at around 10%, employers are really acting with impunity now, and they manage through a routine of workplace authoritarianism. I've argued for a federal Just Cause law. I think it needs to be an amendment to the Fair Labor Standards Act. According to a survey by Data for Progress and YouGov, 56% of voters agree. Only 30% of voters oppose the idea of a federal right to your job. The rest, I suspect, think that it already is the law because it seems reasonable enough that it should be the law. But it's clear the bosses are relying on the anti-majoritarian parts of our federal government, the Senate, the Electoral College, to thwart this popular agenda. It is a saving grace for our democracy that local governments like New York City are willing to consider the protections that workers need and Congress will not consider. We have plenty of workplace protection laws, as the industry representatives were saying. You know, you're not supposed to be fired for your race, your gender, your age, or sexual orientation until the Supreme Court comes after that one. The problem is, A, that they're special protections, but B, the law puts the onus on the employee to make a case that the termination was fair. The employer just gets to make the termination. And of course, it's worse when there's no cause at all, which I understand in this industry you're generally not fired. You just don't see yourself on the schedule next week. You don't see yourself on the schedule the week after that. And by then, you've probably had to go get another job, because who can live without a paycheck for 2 weeks? What just cause requires of employers is not onerous. And I'll say that in a previous life, I was an organizing director for the American Federation of Teachers. I had a staff of 50 people around the country, everybody covered by a collective bargaining agreement. Very complex work requiring a tremendous amount of discretion and judgment by the employees. And I was able to manage. It requires clear communication, some counseling, some training, and some warnings. Basic human decency. And I would say, so Van Arsdale is just a labor studies school. Sometimes labor studies is sort of put in the management school. Fortunately, that for my temperament, we're not in that case. But I do have a lot of respect for management as a science, far more than most corporations do. Human resources and management, they're academic disciplines, they're professions, it's a field of study. And it needs to be taken seriously. So even though we're focused on making frontline fast food jobs livable here, one happy side effect of this law, I think, would be to raise the standards for supervisors. A manager of a McDonald's store is really a branch manager of a global brand representing a Fortune 500 company. That should be a middle-class profession, which entails not just a reasonable salary, but also minimum standards of education and support for training. So whatever gloss the industry puts on it, all I hear is, please don't make us invest in our people. And I say to you, please make them invest in their people. If I may, there was a question that was asked a couple panels ago that I'd like to respond to in terms of, are there other industry models of just cause and arbitration? And I would say there are. We don't have to travel very far geographically. We might have to go a little bit back in time, but it's actually the restaurant industry itself, which was once upon a time fully unionized. Not just the high-class restaurants, not just the restaurants in hotels, but also the fast food of its day, the cafeterias and automats. It all got organized in a two-year period, 1937 to 1938, after the industry had spent 20 years fighting these union efforts. A tremendous number of strikes happened. And what happened is the industry made peace with the fact that there was going to be a union. The nation's laws had changed, the state's laws had changed. You had a governor that was going to weigh in on the workers' behalf. You had a mayor that was going to weigh in on the workers' behalf. And the industry decided, you know, that if it's going to happen, they want it to happen in a way that improved their business. And they all developed an impartial chairman model of employment relations, which is where there is an arbitrator that both parties agree. There's a term of office for that person. And it develops almost a sort of a voluntary court of not quite law, but a voluntary court where there's a shared understanding of what the standards are for certain jobs, what the training standards are, what the employment standards are, what the sort of punishment standards should be. And before it even went to arbitration, there was always a step of mediation, of sort of, let's see your case, let's see our case. How hard do you want to fight this? How hard do we want to fight this? This model still exists in the hotel industry, and it's very successful. I used to work for the Hotel Trades Council, and I think that at least 90% of grievances actually wind up getting settled out. It does require an employer making peace with the fact that there's going to be a union, and from the industry panel, it didn't sound like they're there yet.
Okay. Good afternoon, Chair Miller and committee members, Councilman Lander. My name is Zubin Soleimani. I'm a staff attorney with the New York Taxi Workers Alliance. We're 21,000 members strong, union of yellow cab drivers, drivers of green cabs, and black cars. And the Taxi Workers Alliance is really proud today to stand with our brothers and sisters working in the fast food industry, with 32BJ and with Fast Food Justice to support intros 1396 and 1415. The goals of these bills, to create a just cause standard for terminations, clear standards for progressive employee discipline, and clear written explanations for terminations, are essential to economic security for fast food workers and for all workers. For the Taxi Workers Alliance and for our app-based driver members, the struggle of fast food workers to not only establish a right to decent wages, but to build upon those rights with real economic security and job security is a really familiar one to us. Like fast food workers, app-based FHV drivers are predominantly immigrants or people of color working at low wages, but who've both recently won laws or rules that provide some $15 an hour standard of earnings, whether in the minimum wage or through the TLC driver minimum pay protections. But for all these workers, those protections, whether passed by law or regulation, can't provide economic stability when your boss, whether it's Chipotle or whether it's Uber, can simply fire you for a bad reason or for no reason at all, or cut your full-time schedule in half overnight. And drivers know too well this economic security of unfettered, arbitrary terminations and schedule reductions. So, I mean, we've had so many of our members have been fired upon the mere allegation of misconduct by an app-based company with no meaningful or impartial opportunity to contest the accusations against them. And like fast food workers, who so many of them don't even get a reason for their explanation, in the majority of cases where our members are fired by Uber or Lyft and they ask, what is this about? Please explain so I can have a chance to explain to you my side of the story. They will not tell them what fare it relates to, even what day it happened on. It makes it a complete impossibility for the driver to contest the fairness of these terminations. There are whole categories of misconduct where the companies won't even allow the driver to make a case, even if they tell them what it's about. You know, a common occurrence is we have a devout Muslim driver who's a member of ours, never had a drink in his life, and is accused of driving while intoxicated. And in those cases, the companies won't even begin to let the driver make their case. You know, likewise, many of our members toil with irregular and uncertain schedules. And in recent months, the for-hire vehicle companies have tried to dodge the purpose of the minimum driver payment rules by forcibly logging off drivers from the apps when they're working, reducing their hours, reducing their income. And they'll do this, typically the idea is based on the number of trips the drivers performed in a recent period. And that puts the drivers in the position of saying, you know, one trip back to Bangladesh to visit a dying family member, or 1 week out with the flu puts you in a position where you're eligible for full-time work to suddenly no longer being eligible for full-time work, then putting you at risk to not be able to make a car payment, losing your vehicle, or at risk of eviction. It shouldn't be the case that in our city, people who make some of the largest private companies in the world function can simply be tossed aside without a reason or any due process. The council has the opportunity to create economic stability for fast food workers, and if the $15 minimum wage offered them the promise of decent income and a livable income for fast food workers, these intros help secure that promise. We urge you to pass these bills, and we look forward to seeing the council take similar steps to fulfill the promise of the minimum payment rules for app-based drivers as well. I also do just want to, on the record, make one comment in response to our friend from the Business Council, who spoke to the sort of unknowability of the standard for just cause. You know, we've represented our members in unemployment hearings and have prevailed against Uber in unemployment hearings on substantive issues and also on the question of employee status. And so the idea that an employer in New York State doesn't know what just cause is really curious to me, because although it won't get you your job back, when you apply, you can get unemployment benefits. And for 80 years, every employer in the state of New York has had to contend with that threshold in order to win an unemployment case. So they're all thoroughly familiar with this. This is a well-developed body of law. And frankly, I think these intros will probably help them reduce some of their liability and their bottom line, because in making sure that folks are providing a clear written determination for why somebody's being employed and serving as a barrier to committing bad cause terminations in the first place, they're limiting their liability for increased unemployment benefit payments. So win-win. Right. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to this panel for your testimony. And that is our final panel. Before we shut down, we're going to hear our final words from our lead sponsors of today's legislation, Councilmember Lander and Adams. And okay, Councilmember Lander.
Well, I think that last point, Zubin, was really interesting, and I hadn't thought about it in terms of the relationship to unemployment filings, and it's actually something I think we can drill down a little more on. And then, Mr. Chair, I just wanted to say I enjoyed the dialogue on both the last panel and this one about the dynamic relation between municipal legislation to lift up worker rights and support organizing and collective bargaining, and how we build a model that kind of keeps lifting them both up. And I think there was a lot on this last panel and in your comments about how we do that, and look forward to continuing that conversation, hopefully through this legislation, but far beyond as well. Thank you.
I just want to thank everybody that testified today who's still in the room. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, my colleague, Brad Lander, for the opportunity to be a part of this legislation. And just a footnote, I didn't get an opportunity to say it to our management friends, but to me, it is very, very disheartening to have leaders dismissing employees, and that is the flavor that I got with that particular testimony. To me, it seemed like leadership was in effect dismissing the very folks that enable them to be part of leadership. So I just wanted to put that on the table as well. Thank you again for being here today. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Adams and Lander, for introducing this thoughtful legislation that once again really adds to the legacy of this committee and this council in uplifting the lives of workers throughout the city. And it has transcended industries, although the focus has been oftentimes on fast food and low-wage workers. And I will tell you that working families and workers throughout the city, no matter what industry they are in, have been under siege, and it has been our responsibility to make sure that we continue to protect them as best as possible. These two pieces of legislation, while they will go a long way in protecting the rights of fast food workers, giving them the dignity and that they deserve, and quite frankly, just creating the transparency that is absolutely necessary to transform workers' humanity and dignity. While it is a minimum threshold, it is absolutely necessary, and I look forward to working with you on passage of this legislation. With that, I want to thank everybody for coming out. I want to thank workers for coming out and telling your story, and sometimes your voice is necessary, but it's also painful when telling that story. And in order for us to get where we need to be, we need to hear from you as well. We need to hear from all parties involved in this. Know that this committee is absolutely committed to making sure that we get this right, that we protect the rights of workers, and do it in a way that we're not impeding on businesses, but they have to come to the table. Right, and so I respect and I value all those who give their time to come here and testimony today. With that, this hearing is adjourned.